Good evening. Welcome to the Northampton City Council meeting of March 21st, 2013. I'm City Council President Bill Dwight. I'm presiding. Go figure. Before we actually convene the meeting, we're going to open up for public comment, and here's the rules for public comment. The clock here counts you down. You get 3 minutes. We don't get really upset if you're wrapping up within 3 minutes and you don't have to cut off in the middle of a sentence, but if you decide that you need six more paragraphs, you're not going to be able to do that. And then we also ask you, as you speak, that you just accord respect to the chambers. And yep, that's it. Not too tough. So I'm going to call you up in order of the way you signed up at the podium, and we're going to start with Paul Walker. And I'm sorry, Mr. Walker, I did forget one other thing to announce. If you could once again repeat your name and also your address. Thank you.
Paul Walker, 52 Gilrain Terrace, Florence, Mass. I had not intended to be here this evening, but the Daily Hampshire Gazette changed my mind today. I left our city early this morning with my wife to visit an elderly and dear friend confined to a nursing home. While awaiting breakfast to be served in Keene, New Hampshire, I started glancing through the Gazette we grabbed from the paper delivery boy as we started out on our trip. Today's headlines: possible water sewer rate hikes on Northampton docket. I read that, must mean tonight, and it did. This certainly grabbed my attention, especially after reading the Gazette for the past couple of days and watching local TV all about our school budget, which is very important to all of us, me included. However, all of our city finances have been expressed to be in tough shape. Time does not permit me tonight to dissect the questionable remarks in this article or some of the remarks about our city budget in the last 2 days. However, I feel this subject is most important and should be granted a moratorium by a city council vote, at least a bona fide attempt made by all city officials while proceeding to discuss this matter completely. I have since learned back in June and hearing how speedily this issue is moving ahead with projected cost and impact on homeowners like me and lots of businesses, I decided tonight to press along a few comments from other states which I have gathered and other communities which are working feverishly to save themselves money and perhaps not even having to implement all portions of the EPA demands. Back in June, I picked up a paper where the mayors in this state or in this area visited Washington to request moratoriums. Our mayor was not there. Since then, I've been working with a dear friend of mine out of state, and we have discovered that lots of communities across the United States are in the same boat. California, the closest one to us is Maine, and I'll just make two more comments. A group of Bangor, Maine residents planned to challenge the city's stormwater utility fee on residents and businesses which are starting to have to pay in April. They want to have it put on a referendum vote, but they also are going to a federal court where this has been overruled by the federal courts in the states of Virginia and North Carolina.
Thank you very much, Mr. Walker. Donna Brown, please.
Point of order. Paul's got my glasses.
Paul, you'll need to give him the glasses back there. Otherwise, Council...
I wish to thank Councilor Casey for loaning me his glasses.
Thanks, Paul.
Good evening. Hi, my name is Donna Canuel Brown, and I live at 59th Stage Road in West Hampton. I've been a science teacher at Northampton High School for 20 years. I speak with you tonight to share the cumulative impact of the budget cuts in the science department and the high school over the course of my tenure at the high school. When I arrived in 1993, there were 9 science teachers and about 700 students, or about 80 students per science teacher. Today, there are 7 science teachers for over 900 students, or about 130 students per teacher. This number is an increase of about 70% in these numbers over the last 2 decades. When I arrived, each department had a department head who taught a reduced course load. This person participated in the supervision and evaluation of faculty within his department. The department head also was in charge of coordinating and developing curriculum across the department. The department head served the department members as an easily accessible source of advice and problem solving for faculty seeking out such services. Also working under the supervision of the department head was a full-time laboratory assistant who assisted teachers with laboratory setup and breakdown. Both of these positions have been eliminated for several years, along with the support that they offer. Shortly after I arrived at the high school, when the high school adopted the long block classes, the philosophy behind these classes mandated a cap of 16 students per class. And that cap was honored for several years. Today, it's not uncommon for us to have double that number of students in our classes. When I arrived, I was often assigned to work with small classes of 8 to 10 students with demonstrated special needs. Today, I teach the same numbers of students, but I also teach 20 additional students that are their peers. The most recent DOE on-site evaluation report cited a number of areas for improvement for our district. The report cited insufficient evaluation and supervision of teachers. Also cited was a lack of professional development for teachers. Despite these cuts and a lack of financial and professional support, the faculty of Northampton High School has maintained a standard of excellence, evidenced not only by standardized test scores, but by the great number of opportunities offered to our students upon graduation. This is not a coincidence or a stroke of luck. Teachers at the high school have worked hard to shelter our students and the community from the devastating effects of the cuts taken over the years. As you now threaten to further cut our staff, you make it impossible to protect our students from the lack of resources offered to them. I do not know what more the faculty can do to make up for the reduced level of support for our school, and fear that the consequences will compromise the integrity and reputation that the faculty at Northampton High School has worked so hard to maintain, despite the lack of resources available to us. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Brown. Barbara Bitgood, please.
Good evening. My name is Barbara Bitgood, and I live at 304 Hillside Avenue in Holyoke. I am a French teacher at Northampton High School, and I'm also the mother of a kindergartner at Leeds. As both an educator and a parent, I'm very concerned about the consequences of the proposed K-12 cuts and the chronic underfunding of the city's schools year after year. Staffing throughout the schools has already been reduced to the point where students are suffering. For example, a previous cut to the high school world language department resulted in the loss of 2 sections of French. One direct consequence of that cut is that this year we had no staff available to offer the French 5 course to juniors and seniors. Those students were not able to finish their sequence of courses at the high school. They'll have a hole in their college applications that will put them at a disadvantage when applying to the highly selective colleges that we're so used to NHS graduates attending. Another consequence, this fall, in order to accommodate the number of students requesting French 3, I agreed to teach a jam-packed section of 35 students. and we still had to turn away some kids. With so many students in one class, it was impossible to provide each individual the attention they needed. I couldn't get to know each student's strengths and weaknesses. I couldn't spend one-on-one time with my struggling students. With a group of 35, just getting a moment to spend with each of them each day was very difficult. Sometimes all an at-risk student needs is 5 or 10 minutes of personal attention, but there was no way I could provide that last semester to those kids. So these were the consequences of eliminating just two sections in one department. That's a 33% cut to one position. Now, in this budget that we're facing, we're looking at the elimination or reduction of 10 teaching positions at the high school. That equals 18 courses, affecting nearly 500 students who will need to be crammed into classrooms that already typically have 25, 30, or more students. A further concern is that the new mass course standards for high school graduation set forth by the state go into effect with the current sophomore class. So NHS graduation requirements need to be increased. More math, more foreign language, arts, electives like technology, in order to meet those standards. So at current staffing levels, we cannot offer enough courses for our students to graduate. Our underclassmen are not on track to meet the mass core requirements, and further cuts will be absolutely devastating. So the solution is not to put teachers and students and parents in the situation of scrabbling for what little money there is. I don't want to see cuts at Leeds or JFK or any of the other schools in order to preserve positions at the high school. We shouldn't have to make those kinds of decisions. A cut at one school hurts every school. A cut of one teacher hurts every teacher and every child. So I'm begging you to fully fund our schools based on sound educational principles and what is best for our kids.
Thank you very much. Well timed. Robert Raymond, please.
Members of the council. Robert Raymond, 18 West Shore Drive, Goshen, Massachusetts. And I'm here to address the council to request their support for the proposed zoning change on Route 10 East Hampton Road. The zoning change would be to a light industrial. And I have a parcel of land there that I would be delighted to join the city in trying to attract some small and medium-sized businesses if this zoning change were to take place, and develop the parcel, co-develop the parcel, or possibly sell parcels off to these companies that would come to the city of Northampton, bringing new tax revenue for the properties that they would build and create new jobs, and keeping an impact minimum to the city for bringing these new resources to the town. And my experience here is that I'm just recently completing the Danko Plaza just north of Northampton on Route 5 and 10. And we took basically an empty 63,000 square foot plaza that had one 16,000 square foot tenant that they are now, were fully leased, all 63,000 square feet. This parcel had 5 employees working there and was barely generating $1.2 million 3 years ago. We now have over 75 people working there, and the plaza is now generating somewhere in the neighborhood of over $7 million, and not a single taxpayer's dollar was invested in it. So I respectfully request your attention to the zoning change, if we could.
Thank you very much. Susan Craig, open.
Hi, my name is Sue Crago. I live at 4 Warfield Place here in Northampton. Last night I went to the mayor's talk about the budget, and I understand that things are tight. They're always tight. Every year this time we come here and have this discussion, not so much from the high school to you, but you know, within the city and within the schools. When the United States first started having public high schools, they built them on the conveyor belt system, so that when the bell rang and the kids went to first period or whatever their first class was, they got math dumped on them, and then they went to the second class after the bell and got English dumped on them, and through so on and so on. We all went through that sort of system. And I maybe shouldn't say dumped on, but laid on them or whatever. Things are different now. We don't have a school system anymore that's supposed to teach our kids how to function in a factory environment. Those jobs don't exist anymore. And so the things that teachers have had to do have changed a lot. The way we teach has changed. There's no more just chalk and the blackboard and a book. There are a lot of other things, as you know, that cost a lot of money to make us be able to do our jobs. As a teacher at the high school, I've been there for 9 years. I've been a teacher for 28. Things have changed a lot since I've been there, as my colleagues have stated. And the cuts that are coming are, you know, as you know, devastating. I'm here to ask you tonight, in light of what the mayor said the other day, last night, to consider making a few changes to the city, and to consider reallocating funds, if possible, to the schools. I'm not going to recount numbers because my colleagues have done a good job, I think, of saying how things used to be at the high school and how they are now. And I will say that I agree with them that we've pretty much, as a staff, bent over backwards to keep the integrity of our school and not let our students feel the hit that has been coming over and over again. Listening to the mayor last night, I did ask him a question about why we have two school districts within our district, why we fund two superintendents, et cetera. And I think it's really important for us at this point in our history and in our funding to take a look at the whole big picture of what we do and make some really hard decisions and some changes in order to continue offering our children the education that they deserve and to prepare them for the life that is waiting for them outside of this town or in the town after they're done with school. Even jobs in the military now require much more skill than they used to, with the high level of technology, with our weapon systems and everything. So kids who used to be able to just get out of high school and go have a career in the military, it's much more complicated than that. So I'm asking you to do a few things. One, if you find the money, if you pass a Prop 2.5, allocate more money for the schools so that we can keep doing our jobs or even do them better than we do them now. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Bob Melnick, please.
I brought a few props just because I thought it was important to show what we actually do in our shops. My name is Bob Melnick. I live at 36 Briar Hill Road in Williamsburg, Massachusetts. I am the engineering, design, technology, architecture, drawing, and a woodshop teacher. And last year, I was voted Teacher of the Year in Northampton High School, and this year, I am set to get a cut in the number of classes I teach, and thus my pay as well. And hopefully, it will not be harsh enough that I'll have to go and find a job someplace else. But these are the kind of things that happen when you start cutting some of the teachers that make a difference in some of our kids' lives. I first want to say that my colleagues and myself have done ourselves a huge disservice over the years by being so good at our jobs and being able to absorb these crippling budget cuts. Well, should have been crippling budget cuts, but we've been able to absorb them and, like my colleague said, shield our students from them. My materials budget for all those classes I have end up being around $17 per kid. And you can see the quality of work that I demand. This is and these came from two very ordinary students within the population of NHS. Not necessarily honor roll. Some of these students that are my best students are some of my colleagues' worst students. And I have a place for them. And in order to run our shop, we've had to go outside of the budget. The people at Florence Casket Company, I love the chance that I can get this on NCTV. They've been great. The people, Steve and Lance at the Florence Casket Company, have donated 99% of the wood that we use. The PTO has given us grant money to buy some new machines when our old ones were dying, or just to resurrect the wood shop. The wood shop hadn't run for, I don't know, 10 years, I was told, and we resurrected in the last couple years on basically a shoestring budget the PTO gave us, and my former employer, Minichog, donated probably roughly $10,000 worth of machines that they weren't going to move into their new school. So the arts and tech courses do the same basic thing for our students. They teach them basic skills, they broaden their horizons, and we try to open up the world to them. But we do it in a different way. And for example, when's the last time anyone came to school to watch their kid take a math test? Doesn't happen. You come to school to see them perform in a play. to do a concert. When's the last time you got a biology lab under the Christmas tree for a present? These things are wonderful presents. They stay in the house forever. I'm 35, and I have stuff I made when I was in seventh grade at my parents' house still. It's meaningful, and it's something that a kid might not be good at the academic classes. They come to my room, and it's not just the woodshop, but this is the one I had the best props for. They come in, and they're a success that they hadn't been successful before. I have kids tell me, I took physics my senior year because I liked your Engineering the Future class so much, and it's very physics-based. I have kids, I'll wrap up now. I had this week, the news got out, and people that I stayed in touch with that have graduated over the years came to me and said, what can we do? And actually, this is a former student's table. He graduated last year. But these are the kids that one's working for a cabinet maker. He found his dream job because of the classes he took with me. A lot of them say end up going into engineering because of the Engineering the Future class. This is not something that's necessarily for every kid to change their lives, but those few that we do, it's worth keeping these choices for our students untouched because it's just too important.
Thank you very much. Ruth McGrath.
Good afternoon. My name is Ruth McGrath. I live at 52 Longview Drive in Florence. I'm a member and secretary of the Committee on Disabilities here in Northampton. I'm here this afternoon to speak in support of Ordinance 22-97 through 22-99, Committee on Disabilities. This amendment will change the name of the committee to the Commission on Disability and remove associate members who are currently non-voting members. I've been one of those associate members since 2007. These changes will bring us in line with Mass General Law and allow us to continue to work with events planned for the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Tara Winters, please.
Hi, I'm Tara Winters. I live at 36 Petticoat Hill Road in Williamsburg. And I am a first-year teacher at Northampton High School, special education. I teach 10th and 12th grade learning strategies. After over 10 years of teaching, including 7 years as a tutor in Northampton, I gave up my tutoring business when I was offered the position at Northampton High. This is the only job I applied for. I wanted to work with the incredible faculty, the caring, involved parents that we have in this community, the rich curriculum, and the excellent direction under Nancy Athis and Brian Lombardi. Our school's reputation and ability to provide this level of education is at stake. I've already had phone calls from concerned parents that I talk to regularly, already looking at other schools that do provide arts and other subjects that are looking at cuts. I field questions every day from my students that are worried, are they creating a false schedule for this fall? Will some of their favorite teachers be here next year? Here's the issue. Students come, as I see it, and I've recommended all of the students I've ever tutored to come to Northampton High, their home school, for the breadth of choices we offer and the excellent reputation. And I believe they deserve to have choices. The students will be hurt, and the course choices they'll be forced to make may not best serve their academic needs. Stealing away choice will be a huge detriment and could negatively affect our community for years to come. I don't believe we can halt our students' creativity. Students who shine in the arts and technology and music, giving them important global skills that they will use in all of their futures and ours by cutting choice. With these cuts only because there is simply nothing left to cut at our school. I did not know this and understand it until I've worked there this year. I feel we're telling students that their unique strengths, where they feel proud and can show the world, their parents, their peers, their teachers in the city, how they shine. These cuts will dissolve the confidence our entire staff and their families and the community have worked so hard to build. If the cuts go through, a multitude of years of layered progress will be lost on our reputation as a school. This will take an interminable amount of time to rebuild, one which money alone simply cannot. The havoc this will wreak on our students' self-confidence, their faith in our community, and our staff's boundless commitment, this will be irreparable. I truly hope the budget allocation process is still heartily under consideration, and that choice will still be an integral part of the Northampton Public Schools community, as it is in our valley. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Marjorie Hess, please.
My name is Marjorie Hess, and I live at 70 Masonic Street in Northampton. I'm a trustee of Forbes Library. The trustees met yesterday and unanimously voted to support the City Council resolution of March 7, 2013, urging the state legislature to adopt fair and equitable tax reform to raise substantial revenue, a sufficient portion of which will be allocated to local aid, so that the City of Northampton can continue to provide the level of public service its citizens require and deserve. Excuse me. Included in that public service is library service, and in Northampton, Forbes Library provides a significant public service. Over 60% of Northampton residents hold active Forbes Library cards, and last year, attendance and usage of the library increased by 20%. In a recent survey of Forbes Library users, the primary request was for more. More programs, more presentations, but most of all, more hours when the library is open. Instead, for the past 4 years, we have been forced to close summer Saturdays, and this year will be no exception. We join the City Council in asking the legislature to adopt fair and equitable tax reform to raise substantial revenue in order to provide the library service our citizens require and deserve. Thank you.
Thank you. Susan Biggs, please.
Before you start the timer, I just want to thank all of you for your really hard work that you do.
You get that free.
Okay, thanks. Right, my name is Susan Biggs. I live at 711 Park Hill Road. I've been a resident since 1998. I'm also a parent of a 16-year-old that has come through Bridge, JFK, and now is a sophomore at NAHS. I'm also here as a chemistry teacher, science department head, and varsity lacrosse coach. I've been teaching for 28 years, my most recent 13 at NHS, and I talk really fast. Just today, so listen carefully, just today, after school, four very eager eighth grade girls arrived in my room with a guidance counselor leading them on a tour of NHS. They always come in my room because it's always packed with kids after school. Three lived in Northampton and one from Williamsburg. All four currently enrolled in schools not in the Northampton public school system. One at PVA, one at Williston, and two at Stony Burnham. This is not unusual. Every year between 70 and 100 students enroll at NHS that were not at any Hamp public schools the previous year. While I will say we do lose about 30 to go outside, so it's still a net gain. While I bragged about what a great place Northampton High School is, underneath I had a very heavy heart thinking about just what our high school will look like next year and the limited arts opportunities that they will have access to, not to mention the large sizes of the other classes that they will have access to. Further, I'd like to brag to you about my 50 AP chemistry students who just yesterday won the award for the highest average of all the scores at the Chemistry Olympiad to win the AP Team Award. We've won this award before, 5 times in the last 6 years. Also, of the 300 students from 12 area schools that were there, 32 were selected to advance to rounds 2 and 3 during yesterday's competition. Northampton AP chemistry students made up 19 of those 32 students. We anxiously await word to see if any of our students will progress on to the national exam. As I push these students hard, they do high quality work in this college level course that, believe it or not, is a 10 credit course in college. But I can tell you that it is so important to these students that they continue to have the chance to pursue other opportunities. Today, after they finished, even after being tested yesterday, they finished an 80-minute exam from me. I asked them all to tell me what arts courses they have taken or would like to take at NHS. And by arts, I mean everything. Woodshop, culinary, which is downstairs and smells unbelievably good, comes up 2 floors to me every day. Even as their hardcore science teacher, I know the importance of these opportunities that we provide for them, and I'm begging you, as the Northampton City Councilors, to find a way to reallocate money to bring more support back to the school system and the Northampton High School to maintain the robust arts programs and opportunities that we've had and don't want to lose at Northampton High School. I'll take my last 25 minutes. Arts, foundation in arts, woodshop, art, photography, culinary and art, band, foundations in theater, acting seminar, photography, PE, theater, AV, and cooking, band in the pit, wood tech twice, foundations in theater. The arts really big, oh no, theater really big because she said it was really important. Chamber choir, directing a show in the spring, took photography, foundations theater, foundations in art, ceramics, photography, and on and on and on. Only one kid said I haven't taken arts and I'm not going to at NHS. It'd be a shame to lose it.
Thank you very much. Nick Leda.
Hi, my name is Nick Leda. I live at 65 South Street in Northampton. First of all, I'd just like to take a moment to thank several of you for speaking with me over the last couple days. I know I've called a bunch of you. But I'd like to address the proposed amendment to the billboard zoning bylaw. And the first thing I'd like to say about it is that I think it's very misleading to include a ban on reconstruction of billboards in a zoning bylaw that purportedly is only to ban LED lighting, which I think is something that probably more of you are in favor of banning. Second thing I'd like to say is that banning the reconstruction of pre-existing billboards, it completely ignores the economics of how billboard leases actually work. And what I mean by that is that the landowners, which are typically Northampton residents, almost never own the billboards on their land. Generally speaking, they lease the right to construct a billboard to a big national advertising firm, which then subleases the right to the actual advertising space on the board. As a result, since they don't own the billboard, their only mechanism in the lease, if the tenant doesn't pay rent or says they want to pay less rent, their only mechanism to deal with their tenant is to say, take down the billboard, because I can go reconstruct an identical billboard as long as it's no more, no larger and no more non-conforming than the previous one, and I can get a new tenant who hopefully will pay me more money or be a better tenant. The issue is that if you take away that right from the landowner, it creates an incredible amount of unfairness towards the landowner and gives the monopoly to these big national advertising firms that lease these billboards they actually own these billboards. And I just don't understand why the town would want to put something in place that's going to put our residents at such a huge disadvantage and be such a windfall to national organizations that really have nothing to do with Northampton. As another example of that, as this slowly drives down the rental rates of those billboards, a side effect of that is that the assessed value of all these properties is going to go down because the properties are primarily assessed just based on how much rent the landlord can collect from these billboard companies. And so, you know, a piece of land that might otherwise be worthless could be assessed for hundreds of thousands of dollars just because it has a valuable, you know, billboard that it can rent out on it. The first thing I would like to ask is simply that LED lighting ban and the ban on reconstruction be considered separately as two separate votes, because it's very unfair to lump them together. And the second thing is, of course, to defeat the ban on reconstruction of billboards. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's the last person who was signed up. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak at this time? Yes.
Terrified by the 3 minutes. My name is Elizabeth Slade. I live at 368 Chesterfield Road in Leeds, and I am the mother of a junior, Isaac Price Slade, on the front of the paper this morning, who's been heavily involved in the arts, and two children that will come into the high school. And I just want to say how impressed I am by the faculty at the high school and pledge my support for the arts and keeping it there. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else wish to speak?
All right.
Sure.
I'm a terrible public speaker, but I'm making myself do this.
It's the bar is pretty low here.
Okay. My name's Jana Ugoni. I live at 35 Norfolk Avenue in Northampton, Mass. I don't have anything prepared, but I grabbed an article that I've kept in my files for a long time. I actually made everybody a copy, and it's called The Creativity Crisis, and it's from a Newsweek article. I'm just going to read you a couple of excerpts that were really moving. It's basically about a test that was done back in 1958 by he's recapping something that he went through. Let me just start. Back in 1958, Ted Swatcher's Rock, which we'll just call Ted, was an 8-year-old third grader when he became one of the Torrance Kids, a group of nearly 400 Minneapolis children who completed a series of creativity tasks newly designed by Professor E. Paul Torrance. Ted still vividly remembers a moment when a psychologist handed him a fire truck and asked, "How could you improve this toy to make it better and more fun to play with?" He recalls the psychologist being excited by his answers. In fact, the psychologist session's notes indicate Ted rattled off 25 improvements, such as adding a removable ladder and springs to the wheels. That wasn't the only time he impressed the scholars, who judged him to have unusual visual perspective and an ability to synthesize diverse elements into meaningful products. The accepted definition of creativity is production of something original and useful. That's what was reflected in the test. There's never one right answer. To be creative requires divergent thinking, generating many unique ideas, and then convergent thinking, combining those ideas into the best result. In the 50 years since Ted and others took their tests, scholars first led by Torrance, now his colleague, blah, 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 have been tracking the children, recording every patent earned, every business founded, every research paper published, and every grant awarded. They tallied the books, dances, radio shows, art exhibitions, software programs, advertising campaigns, hardware innovations, music compositions, public policies written or implemented, leadership positions, invited lectures, and buildings designed. Nobody would argue that Torrance's task, which had become the gold standard in creativity assessment even today, measure creativity perfectly. What's shocking is how incredibly well Torrance's Creativity Index predicted those kids' creative accomplishments as adults. Those who came up with more good ideas based on creativity training on Torrance's tasks grew up to be entrepreneurs, inventors, college presidents, authors, doctors, diplomatic software developers, and on. The correlation of lifetime creative accomplishment was more than 3 times stronger for childhood creativity than childhood IQ. It goes on to say one thing that I thought was quite interesting as well. Plucker, this person who's another accomplished person in the field, recently toured a number of such schools as Shanghai and Beijing. He was amazed by a boy who for...
Go ahead.
Okay, I'll do it really quickly. Who for a class science project rigged a tracking device for his moped with parts from a cell phone. When faculty of a major Chinese university asked Plucker to identify trends in American education, he described our focus on standardized curriculum, rote memorization, and nationalized testing. After my answer was translated, they just started laughing out loud, Plucker says. He said, "You're racing towards our old model, but we're racing toward your model as fast as we can." It's an excellent article, and it goes on to show how much creativity builds both sides of the brains, balances these kids in more ways than any of us can imagine. And it also helps these kids who are pushed in so many directions to get into the right school at the right time in a way that allows their creativity to build to balance them. We're going to set them off into this world right now, and they need problem solving. They need all kinds of creativity tools in their basket to go out there and conquer. If we take this from them, it's not just a budget cut. This is really, these are our leaders.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak? Okay, I'm going to ask the clerk to call the roll and we'll convene.
Councilor Adams?
Here.
Councilor Carney?
Present.
Councilor
Here.
Councilor
Here.
Councilor Barr?
Present.
Murphy?
Here.
Councilor
Schwartz?
Here.
Councilor
Tosin? Here. We're going to start with communications from the mayor, and he's present with his proclamation.
Good evening, esteemed members of the City Council. It's good to be with you this evening. One of the items that I wanted to communicate to you is the issuance of a proclamation. The title of this proclamation is Developmental Disabilities Awareness Month, March 2013. Whereas individuals with developmental disabilities, their families, friends, neighbors, and coworkers encourage everyone to focus on the abilities of all people, And whereas public awareness and education enhance a community's understanding of the issues affecting people with developmental disabilities, and whereas the month of March has been designated National Developmental Disabilities Awareness Month, and this year's theme is Look Beyond. This means that when people with disabilities are welcomed into local neighborhoods, workplaces, houses of worship, and schools, everyone wins. And whereas the City of Northampton wishes to join Victoria Regish this year in acknowledging the workers at the Northampton Office of the Commonwealth's Department of Developmental Services who help her in caring for her sons, Renee, age 52, and David, who turned 50 on February 19th. Now, therefore I, Mayor David J. Narkowitz, do hereby proclaim March 2013 to be Developmental Disabilities Awareness Month in the City of Northampton. I urge all of us to support every effort to enable residents with developmental disabilities, such as the Regish sons, to live full and productive lives of inclusion in our community. In witness whereof, I have set my hand and imprinted the seal of the City of Northampton this 7th day of March, 2013. And I, Ms. Regish is sitting, and I'd like to present the proclamation to her.
Thank you.
Vicki, you want to say a few words?
The mayor said it all. Thank you all. When I moved here, I had my son. I didn't put him in an institution, and I'd do it all over again. I'd like to say a few words about my past. I'll do it all over again. I'm worried about the present and the future, about staff living next door. I'm the next door neighbors now. Thank you all.
Thank you, Vicki. The mayor also has a presentation, a health insurance update that's actually been associated with part of the conversations that he has with his budget presentations.
Thank you. Yes, I wanted to also come this evening to give the council an update on our municipal health insurance. As you may recall, this has been one of the large issues contributing to our current budget gap. And you may also recall that in my updates with you and as part of the presentations that I've been making around the city, we began the process looking at about a 10% increase in our cost for health insurance this year in renewing with our current provider, which is roughly about $1 million. You may also recall that last fall, this council, I brought before you Mass General Law Chapter 32B, Section 21 through 23, the new Municipal Health Insurance Reform Law, which this council adopted 6-3 on that day. As we begin our health insurance process this year, in doing our analysis and trying to solicit quotes from other providers, we are going to invoke the new authority that I've been given under this health insurance reform law. And I will be proposing to our bargaining units and our retirees a plan to transfer our health insurance coverage into the Group Insurance Commission, or the GIC. This is a plan that we will we are beginning a conversation with our with our employee bargaining units and our retirees. There's a process that we need to follow, and the plan that we're proposing is effectively to renew our coverage with our current plan for the first 6 months of the upcoming fiscal year, July 1 until December 31st, and then on January 1st, 2014, we would move into the Group Insurance Commission. That is the next eligible date that we would be, that any municipality would be eligible to move into the GIC, would be January 1st. There's two entry points. either July 1st or January 1st, and there's kind of a six-month notice period and lead-up period. So this would be the earliest opportunity. We have calculated that the total 12-month calendar year 2014, so keep in mind it's calendar year 2014, which will span two fiscal years, we are projecting premium savings from this transfer to the GIC at about $1.322 million, of which we would commit 25% of those savings in the first year to a mitigation fund, which we are required to do under the reform law. So what would this mean for 2014? Because again, we're primarily focused right now on the impacts on our FY 2014 budget. And again, that 10% increase in health insurance would effectively drop to about 1% or a little less than 1% in terms of that 10% gap. So that $2.4 million gap that we've been speaking about, that would be reduced by about $900,000, which would lower our gap, our current budget gap, to about $1.5 million. Obviously, that's a significant change to the good. It's obviously not all the way to the good, but health insurance has been one of the major cost drivers in this and every other budget. And then, obviously, my other hope is that this will be savings that we will continue to enjoy going forward. The GIC this year issued their overall kind of rate increase, and it was about an average of about, I think it was 3% is the number that they use for their increase. Now they kind of take the average of all their various plans and come up with that, so depending on which plan you would move into, you know, some have gone down, some have gone up, but we believe that this is a very responsible move to make, particularly given the rising costs of our health insurance. I would also note that when we did go out to bid, no other carriers bid on our insurance, making the decision sort of that much clearer for us. So again, this is a proposal at this point, so we will project these savings as part of our budget analysis. We still have to go through first the IAC process, which is an existing process that we already use. Then we will move into that new process, which involves the PEC committee, which we will then have negotiations with and try to reach agreement on this proposal. But I wanted to update you on that because it is a significant change in our budget status, and I guess wanted to again thank you for giving the city, I think, the ability to use this health insurance reform to try to create more savings in this very important area of our budget. I will again keep you posted on this as we move along, and we are continuing to look at all of these numbers, these revenue numbers, these expenditure numbers over the next several weeks, and obviously with an eye towards the House budget, which will be coming out. We hope we'll start to hear more about it at the end of March, beginning of April, which may be the next point where we may get some information that may affect our numbers. But this is a significant one, and I wanted you to be aware of it. If you have any questions, I can try to answer them for you.
Councilor Tacey.
Yeah, there's a misnomer out there that health insurance covers our retirees also, the same health insurance that we're talking about. It's not a separate thing from the retirement board.
Yeah, they are members of our...
They're all members.
They are, exactly, yes.
I wanted to make that clear because...
They are, and they would continue to be... There are retirement plans within the GIC as well, and they would continue to be part of. And in fact, they are represented... they have a represented seat on both the IAC as well as the PEC boards that will be part of this negotiation process.
Our retirees' health insurance is all part of this same big picture. It's not separate.
That is correct.
Board, and that's a misnomer that's been out there. And
yeah, retirement board manages retirement benefits.
Period.
Health insurance benefits are still managed by the city.
Thank you.
And the only other thing I would add is that you know, currently our employees have Health New England, which is our plan, and one of the biggest providers in the GIC is also Health New England. And part of the analysis that we have to do in order to do this, make this kind of a proposal, is make sure that there's a comparable plan. And I believe that this will, that when folks have a chance to look at it, that I believe that they'll find it very comparable to what we're already offering with our private contract with Health New England.
Thank you for the creativity.
Councilor LaBarge and then Councilor Freeman Daniels.
Thank you. I do know with the GIC, it's really an excellent health insurance. The retirees also are offered dental, are also offered eye care. So they get treated very, very well if they're retired, no matter what facility it is. GIC is excellent, and it's broken down. I think there's like four different types of groups which you can join.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. Yes. It's excellent, and I'm very happy to hear this because I know we have heard about our problems with the health insurances, and I know bringing it up with our former mayor when she was looking at that of going into the GIC, I'm really happy to see that we're working on something. Because this is a significant amount of savings. And this has been really hurting our budget big time.
Most definitely. And we will now, one of the goals of the GIC is to provide that larger bargaining power of the state, which now, instead of the city of Northampton going out to bid, it will be the Commonwealth of Massachusetts going out to bid with all of the member employees who are part of that. And again, there's a choice of plans. It's not just one plan. There's a cafeteria choice of plans. So again, I believe in terms of our former mayor, Mayor Higgins, I want to acknowledge the work she did over time because she was an advocate for creating the ability for cities and towns to be able to go into the GIC. So,
anyone else have any questions?
Sir,
he changed his mind.
Okay. So again, I will again give you updates when I have them on this and other matters related to the budget. And while I'm at the podium, I would remind people that I've finished four of my town hall budget meetings, and I have two more scheduled. Not next week, but beginning the week after. April 1st will be at the Ryan Road School at 7 p.m. And then on Wednesday, April 3rd, will be at the Florence Community Center at 7 p.m. For, again, updates. And we will be working to update this information to incorporate into that presentation as well.
Well, it should also be mentioned that this is an opportunity for give and take. You're soliciting input from the community.
Most definitely. And I've gotten lots of great input. We've had lots of great discussions, including last night at the high school with lots of very engaged high school students. So it was a pleasure and an honor to have a dialogue with them.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
We've now come to the portion where we are going to have a second reading apropos of the tax reform resolution. I'm inclined to read this if everyone's okay with that.
Okay.
I think, given the context, it seems. This is upon the recommendation of the City Council and the School Committee Conference Committee. It's a resolution. Whereas, beginning in 1998, there have been significant changes to the state tax code, including a series of phase cuts to the state personal income tax from 5.95% to 5.3%, and cuts in the tax rate applied to dividend and interest income from 12% to 5.3%. Whereas the net effect of all state tax reductions and increases since 1998 is the total tax revenue as a share of the state personal income has declined by 1 percentage point from 6.3% in FY 1998 to 5.3% FY 2012, amounting to a loss of $3.8 billion in annual tax revenue for the Commonwealth, according to the Massachusetts Budget and Policy Center. Whereas the substantial decline in revenue has produced an ongoing fiscal crisis for the Commonwealth, resulting in deep funding cuts and essential public investment and compromising the state's long-term growth potential and the current and future well-being of Massachusetts residents. Whereas Northampton state aid has been cut by nearly $4 million since fiscal 22, from $13.5 million in fiscal year 22 to $9 million in fiscal year 2013. Whereas Northampton has taken every possible measure to raise local revenue to offset the impact of state aid cuts, including the passage of a $2 million general operating override for the fiscal year 2010, the adoption of local hotel and meals taxes and increases in parking fines and other fees, including licenses and permits, water and sewer rates, and trash disposal. Whereas Northampton has implemented dozens of cost-saving measures and continues to do so, including consolidation of departmental functions, adoption of municipal health insurance reform, implementation of major energy improvements and performance management systems. And whereas for the fiscal year 2014 budget, Northampton currently faces another substantial budget gap, which will require more cuts to our public school system and city services. And whereas Governor Patrick has recognized the critical need to invest in our education and transportation systems across the Commonwealth in order to preserve and build Massachusetts' economic and social health, and whereas in order to make that investment possible, Governor Patrick has proposed a $1.9 billion progressive tax package that would increase the income tax from 5.25% to 6.25%, while doubling the automatic personal exemptions, and decrease the sales tax from 6.25% to 4.5%, and eliminate a number of specific existing personal income tax exemptions and deductions. And whereas the State Senator Sonia Chang Diaz and Senator State Representative Jim O'Day, along with our own State Representative Peter Cocott as co-sponsor, have reintroduced the Act to Invest in Our Communities, a bill that would raise $2 billion in revenue through a combination of income tax and capital gains tax increases, while increasing personal and other exemptions, making the tax code more equitable. And whereas the growing recognition that we can no longer expect local communities to preserve basic services without more state revenue makes this legislative session a crucial opportunity to take bold steps for tax reform and investment. Be it therefore resolved, the Northampton City Council, Northampton School Committee Conference Committee urges the state legislature to consider the proposals outlined above and adopt fair and equitable tax reform to raise substantial revenue, a sufficient portion of which will be allocated to local aid so that the City of Northampton can continue to provide the level of service its citizens require and deserve. I'll accept the motion.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Councilor Schwartz?
Yes, I just want to thank fellow members of the Conference Committee on for School Committee and City Council, Councilor Carney and Councilor Adams, and our school committee members, Dan Meyer and Mike Flynn and Blue Duvall, who are presenting this resolution. I of course, want to urge a yes vote on this resolution, and I want to add that we had the opportunity, as many of you may have read and many were in attendance, to have a meeting with our representative, Peter Cocott, a couple of nights ago, and to talk about the state legislation and the potential for state tax reform. And he made it very clear he's working very, very hard to garner the necessary votes to pass this kind of progressive tax reform that will raise these revenues. And we know that there is no guarantee about exactly what it will bring Northampton. We'll learn more about that in the coming weeks when the House releases its budget. But we know that at minimum, we need every dollar that we can get out of positive, progressive state tax reform. And this resolution is our way of sending that message. And I just want to encourage everybody out there watching to applaud Representative Cocott for his support of this kind of legislation, and I know Senator Rosenberg is supportive as well, and just to keep the pressure, the support and the pressure for this, for working on the state level so that we can get what we can possibly acquire on that state level and then face what we need to face on a local level to ensure that we stay healthy as a community. But this is a necessary first step.
Anyone else wish to comment? Discussion? Call for a roll call?
No.
Oh, I'm sorry, Councilor Tate.
I listened to Representative Cocott also the other night. And Councilor Schwartz is right. He really could not tell us just exactly. He couldn't tell us too much. He couldn't tell us just exactly how much would come back to Northampton. But he did say one thing, that the formula did not allow for a higher percentage to come back to Northampton. The formula doesn't allow it. and it was going to be a couple of years before we would feel any impacts before we would get any additional funds. It was going to be a couple of years down the line. But it's always a couple of years down the line. So what I would wonder why 2 years ago maybe something didn't roll around, or 4 years ago, or 6 years ago, or 8 years ago. And I know that when we had $155 million windfall to Chapter 90 throughout the state, I dug into that also. And it for Northampton, it amounted to $21,000, I think, to the Chapter 90 funds, which didn't even cover the cost of the increase in diesel fuel for that year. Out of the $155 million that was distributed throughout the state, $132 million of that stayed east of Worcester. He also explained that the MTA had such a debt service that it cost more to fund their debt service than it cost them for all of their employees, including their benefits. And we pay for that. If we were so poor with our finances and we had racked up such a debt service in Northampton, they would take us over. We did it in Springfield. So I won't support it unless somebody can tell me that they're going to work on changing the formula and maybe tell us just exactly how much we'll get back. Administration and Finance can't tell us. The DOR can't tell us. Peter Kokut, our representative, he couldn't tell us. I was kind of hoping that Stan Rowe, there was several people that couldn't get there. The weather was bad, but there was a heck of a turnout. There was about 150 to 170 people at the meeting. But there's a lot of questions. I have a lot of questions about just exactly what this is going to do for Northampton before I support it. And at this point, I won't support it.
Councilor Adams and Councilor LeVar. Councilor Carr.
I appreciate those good points. And I don't think that the expectation is that this proposal, if it passed, would solve our situation immediately or in no time in the future at all. But even if that's the case, for me, it's extremely important because it's a more fair way to tax. It's more fair, it's more socially just, and it's a tremendous revenue producer for education and for infrastructure. And those are two things that are that sorely need more funding, and things that we value tremendously. So even though it may not cure our current situation, it is a more fair and just form of taxation that will lead to tremendous revenue. So I support this. I thank Councillor Schwartz and Councillor Carney and the members of the school committee, as well as our state legislators. And I urge everyone to, if you're so inclined, to reach out to your legislators and express your support. Thank you.
Councilor LeBarge, please.
Just like I said last time, 2 weeks ago, I support this 100%. We need to start somewhere. We need whatever we can get. And I feel that we are sending a message, and it's an important message. And if I can recall, with Councilor Schwartz, when we all went to Boston to fight for investing in our community, there's value here. I know people don't like to have their taxes raised, but I think also with Councilor Carney explaining to me, because I had great concerns about capital gain and so forth, and how a lot of discussion will be put in place on this order, on this resolution. So I'm going to support it because we need money. And at this point, we'll take whatever we can get. We need to look at the education part of our schools, to see our youths out there asking for help. It hits you right here. I have never seen this. I've put my children through school, through colleges. I have never, ever seen what went on yesterday in the city of Northampton. And these young children are saying the values of what is needed in our schools. And I support art. I support music 100%. We need the money. And I'm supporting this.
Councilor Curran.
I'll just say that it is very tempting to invoke the spirit of Daniel Shays and all of this, given that We so often see our money that stays back east and we don't get a portion of it, but as Councillor Schwartz pointed out, Representative Cocott and the whole Progressive Caucus is really, really working diligently on this, and this council, this body passed, I'm not sure if it was unanimously, but with strong support, the Act to Invest in Our Communities some 6 months ago. So, you know, what this does is really reiterate that and acknowledge that there are other solutions that are being tossed about here, but that we really need something. The situation's pretty dire right now, and we're just going to have to, you know, count on our own local delegation to bring that piece of it. If they can at least get, you know, some revenue raised, then they could bring that piece back that we so sorely need here. So I'll continue to support it and urge others to.
I'm, as last time, not going to support it. I totally, and I apologize for my voice fading out here today. I totally have empathy for the need that we have here, but I don't see how we solve that need by sending more money to Boston in the hopes that a little of it will come back so that we can spend it in Northampton. I think we need to pressure the state, but we need to pressure the state to give the city of Northampton and all the cities and towns in Massachusetts the ability to generate enough income from within our borders to live up to our obligations. Our need grows at twice the rate that our ability to generate income grows. So we pass an override, and 3 years later, we're right back where we started. That is always going to be the case unless the state becomes a true partner and lets us generate revenue that stays here from here rather than saying, oh, send us some more money so we can help you out. We always, always, always come up on the short end of that stick. And for those reasons, I can't support it. I would love to support some ways to generate revenue for the city of Northampton from within the city of Northampton. But I just can't buy into the fact that we're going to solve our problems by giving the state more money to spend, because I think we've seen right along there are cities with greater need than us in the eyes of the state, and it just doesn't come back to us dollar for dollar. So I just think it's folly to try and solve our problems by exporting more of our dollars 100 miles east in the hopes that some of it will trickle back this way.
Councilor Freeman Daniels.
I'm going to say pretty much what I said last time, which was that I agree with Councilor Murphy in principle, although I have to confess, I haven't looked at the numbers. I don't know if we're a net gainer or net loser when it comes to the income tax collected and sales tax collected out of Northampton. You know, and I can't say what the rest of the communities would look like surrounding ours as well. But I have to agree with him, but I also wholeheartedly agree with Councillor Adams. You know, this is, we're not passing a law here. We're urging our legislators to listen to us as far as our endorsement of good public policy. And it is outside of our ken. It's outside of our control whether they will or not, but we're urging them to pass public policy that is more fair, and it's a more fair way of assessing tax and collecting revenue. And so for those reasons, including social justice, I also will vote aye.
Are you interested in a roll call?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Freeman Daniels?
Aye.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
No.
Councilor Schwartz?
Yes.
Councilor
Taylor? No.
If you'll indulge me, I'm going to take advantage of the fact that I'm going to express an opinion on this now that the vote has passed. And the issues brought up are both germane and relevant. But the more significant feature is the fact that they are not mutually exclusive. What's more important is the fact that we build an equitable tax structure, which is clearly dysfunctional. And we're talking about now as citizens of the Commonwealth, not just citizens of Northampton. And this is the nature and the intent of this resolution. It's why I voted yes, because we're expressing a fair tax system, not based on regressive taxation, not based on your, in many cases, your inability to pay, but based on your ability to pay. And the shared contributions have been born right now. disproportionate burden has been borne on the backs of people in middle class and working poor. And consequently, we sit here and listen to very moving testimony with wrenching pangs of frustration because we have a dysfunctional tax system based on criteria that evolved over time through politicking and manipulating and you know, jerry-rigging systems in order to try and offset deficits. This is a clear, fair, equitable tax proposal that we're advocating for here. It doesn't necessarily mean true that it will mean a net gain for us in revenue. It is a net gain in fairness, ultimately. And then, consequently, one would hope that largesse also translates to more revenue for the communities. At least we can eliminate that one dimension of the frustration that we've been experiencing here. There we go. That was refreshing. I haven't been able to do that in a while, so it's thanks for letting me get that out. We have coming up next, by the way, that resolution is passed. That's the second reading. It's passed the two readings, and it will go forward from here. Presentation from the no? Whoa, you were supposed to hit me. Okay, I'm sorry, this is an opportunity for 1 minute announcements from the councilors. Councilor Schwartz.
I do wanna say, as a follow-up to the meeting that occurred with the legislative forum, that I wanted to give everybody an opportunity if they wanted to be connected to budget updates and possible actions through the local group, Yes Northampton, which is a group of volunteers working on raising sufficient revenue fairly to support our basic services, that people can subscribe to the email list by emailing yesnorthampton@gmail.com. Easy to remember, yesnorthampton@gmail.com, if you'd like to be connected to that information loop, and then you can be put on to the email list.
Thank you. Councilor Barge?
Yes. I placed on each one of the councilors' desks some information that was sent to me today. The PVTA, the paratransit rider meetings that they're going to be having, it's an update on the 5-day advance reservation policy. And we had a meeting with the group from the PVTA about a month ago, and there was a lot of concerns from a lot of people from Ward 3, Ward 6, all over the place, from Amherst, about the change of the system that they had on making reservations. So it's going to be held on Monday, April 8th from 3 to 4 o'clock p.m. at the Northampton Senior Center. And also the PVTA will be providing free van rides for eligible riders to and from this meeting. So if any of you counselors are available, I would appreciate that you could be there. You got it on your desk, Jesse.
Anyone else? All right. Now, and this is also apropos because this actually came up in public comment, but the Board of Public Works Chair Terry Culhane and the DPW Director Ned Huntley are here to present us with an update and an overview on stormwater management fees that's currently being discussed and vetted in an ad hoc committee that's been established by this council. Thank you, Terry.
Okay. Thank you for inviting us. I'm Terry Culhane. I'm on the Board of Public Works.
Point of information. We're discussing stormwater or water sewer?
I'm so water.
Give me a sec. So just to clarify, about a year ago, we raised the water and the sewer rates by approximately 9% in each case. And there were a lot of questions after the fact. I know councilors had questions and the general public had questions. And at the time, we resolved to make sure that this time around and in the future, the city council and hopefully through the magic of television, the public at large, feels more knowledgeable about what's driving the rates, what projects we're working on, and what drove the rate increase, if there is one. And if it's all right, each of you have a piece of paper on your desk. We have reconstructed the budget into a manner that we hope will be easier to discuss. It's not the normal Munis format. Let me just quickly walk you through the water enterprise page. The first thing we did in the top there is group the cost of essentially opening the door in the morning, turning the lights on, and running the plant, and in this case, the distribution system. These are more or less fixed costs of operations and maintenance, the indirect costs for payments in lieu of taxes, employee benefits, and the various support that these enterprise funds give to the city. And finally, the existing debt service, in this case, approximately $2.5 million annually, mostly driven by the water filtration plant, which cost about $26 million. So what we're doing here is comparing this fiscal year that we're in right now with the one coming up. It's just a little snapshot in time of what we're doing. Engineering services are going to go down. That's driven by changes in the projects that we're working on. We're going to continue attempting to acquire land around the reservoirs, the watershed that protects those reservoirs. We did some seasonal work under the heading of reservoir construction last year. That money wasn't all expended, and it's going into this year as well. Upper Roberts Meadow Dam, this will probably be a hot issue at some point. We've already set aside $366,000 for the permitting, design, and engineering work preliminary to working on that dam. You may recall that the Board of Public Works has voted to decommission that dam. It was last used over 100 years ago in any manner for the city. We haven't drawn water from that area, to our knowledge, since the 1800s. The Board of Public Works has determined that, in our opinion, the most economical thing to do with that dam is to decommission it. We see no upside into restoring it and trying to maintain it for the future. We're not interested in it as a source of water.
Thank you. Do you want to save questions for the end, or do you mind taking them?
I don't care. Whatever the council prefers.
So my only question is, does the dam have anything to do, does it mitigate stormwater at all? I mean, is it to
no.
any extent?
Not really. It's so heavily silted that it actually retains a fairly small amount of water. In many places, is it several acres of water?
That's, yeah.
And yet in many places you could walk around and it's this deep. So it doesn't act as a basin that retains water, or at least not to such a degree that it would have some benefit in that role.
Okay.
It does work as a sediment.
Yes.
Let's keep that from going down the brook and under the bridge.
Right.
It does. And so, and there is very little water behind it. As a matter of fact, there's an island in it.
Yeah.
So if it's retaining such little water, then we'll get into that later about the impact it would have if it were to crash, if there's a little water in it. Get into that. Okay. So it doesn't have the 19 million gallons of water in it that it was designed to hold.
I would agree.
Okay.
But the relevant point is that the Office for Dam Safety has told us to take it down or to repair.
No, I understand. I just trying to wrap my head around the GZA reports.
Okay. So we have already set aside this $366,000, and we are proposing further down to take $1 million from our undesignated fund balance to pay for the rest of that work. That $1 million will probably be expended in FY 2015. The point I want to make is we've built up enough of a surplus that we can pay cash for this project. Our feeling is that projects in the order of $500,000, $1 million, maybe a little more than $1 million, are good candidates to pay cash if we can. Large projects, it's probably not practical to save up so much money we could spend $5 million or $10 million. But these million-dollar-ish programs, I think it's worthwhile to consider saving up and paying cash where we can. Even at 2%, the interest on a $1.3 million project would be about $300,000 over the course of paying back that bond. It's a substantial amount of money, and at the moment, we're paying about $1 million annually in interest. We'd like to see if we can begin bringing that number down.
Terry, what would be the cost for repairing it?
We're thinking it's in the neighborhood, if I recall correctly, around 1.9.
They're about the same as the no maintenance cost going forward.
Oh, really? So Ned says the cost to repair it might be about the same.
Thank you.
But and you should add, what he said was it didn't figure in the cost of ongoing maintenance.
Right.
That's because so the folks at home could hear.
Right. So it would be about the same amount of money to repair it, but then we would continue to have a dam there, and we would have ongoing maintenance costs.
Can I ask this just a slightly separate question? This is related to this, you know, sort of accumulating funds inside inside of enterprise fund, and I'm just ignorant. How is that? That's allowed to do it if you have a particular project in mind, or can enterprise funds just forever, you know, accumulate as much as they want inside of themselves? Or
yes, for example, when we could see the filtration plant coming, we knew that suddenly we're going to borrow over $25 million. So what we began doing in advance of that borrowing is raising our rates, and we began to accumulate a surplus. The intention of that surplus was once the bond payments began, we would begin drawing down that surplus. During that period, we would be technically running at a deficit in the sense that we'd have less money at the end of the year than we did at the beginning of the year. The final year of that was, in fact, this year. Despite the 9% increase in our rate last July 1st, we still ran a deficit this year of over $250,000. It's only in FY14 that we will come up to a deficit. So that was a strategy that we instituted over 10 years ago to first build up a reserve. Actually, I should do it this way for you. First build up a reserve, and then that would pay down, and it would soften the blow of suddenly borrowing $25 million.
And that's legal. That's a legal,
totally legal
operation within an enterprise.
If the undesignated fund balance grows to an unseemly amount, you would want to be able to explain what the purpose of it is. But accumulating $1 million and then spending it and then building it up and then spending it,
okay,
absolutely fine.
Thank you.
Councilor Murphy has a question.
I thought I recall that we received considerable grant money to take down the Upper Roberts.
We are, FEMA, through MEMA, has indicated some interest in funding this, but they haven't done anything. And I believe if we move ahead with it, it wouldn't influence our ability to get the grant in retrospectively. Is that correct?
I recall we were after River Road reconstruction, and they preferred funding us for this dam.
No, we have three FEMA grants under consideration right now, one of them being the Upper Roberts Meadow Reservoir. They are the River Road retaining wall project and an erosion problem just below Mizani Beach. Each one of those projects is a 75% reimbursable if it's approved by FEMA. All three projects are currently under review from FEMA still. We have a letter to FEMA regarding paying us back for engineering services work prior to the awarded grant. So that will be included in it if the final grant is awarded. We expect that we should hear about that particular grant this year.
I guess I was mistaken when I thought that they actually granted us funding for Upper Roberts.
No. It's in the works.
But it's reimbursement.
And where do we stand with the other two? I mean, all three of them are in my ward.
I just,
why I ask.
They're all under federal review right now at FEMA,
yeah.
All three grants. They've been recommended by the Massachusetts Emergency Management Agency, MEMA, for funding to FEMA. But FEMA makes the ultimate decision.
Okay. And we are monitoring River Road, that retaining wall, because it looks as though it is sinking ever more.
It is moving.
So the priority would be not trying to put words you want. What would you think? What's the first one? What do you think?
Well, they're all priorities. It mattered that the reservoir project was done 3 years ago, and the other two projects were done 2 years ago. So they're different funding cycles from FEMA also. I mean, I find it kind of hard to understand why it's taken 3 years to make a decision on a project when the funds are in place.
I agree.
I think a point that is perhaps worth making is that of these three projects, only one of them falls under the purview of the Water Enterprise Fund. The other two are stormwater related.
Thank you.
So Upper Roberts Meadow Dam, the radio read program allows a car to drive down the middle of the street and capture water meter data. To date, it's allowed us to reduce that water reading program to 1 meter reader, and we're just gradually retrofitting all of the meters around the city with the radio mechanism.
Excuse me for a second, Terry, just to put people at ease. Google's now had to pay $7 million for grabbing data from people. You're not grabbing data from routers, are you? Just grabbing them from these meters?
It doesn't go through the network, the internet of the house in any way or shape.
So you're better than Google in that respect. When you
much better.
That.
Okay. Much better, but not nearly as wealthy. Vehicle replacement, waterline replacement. We propose bumping that from $350,000 to $400,000. The $350,000 in this year is approximately what we spent on North Street to replace the water line on North Street. It was about $350,000. We can see that the cost of doing a mile of roadway is creeping up along with everything else. This is the line item that we use to do Spring Street, Russell Wood Terrace, Crescent Street, North Street. Now, probably Hinckley or Milton Street are coming up, and Ryan Road is beginning to work its way up toward the front. Meter replacement. They've got great new meters, very exciting technology. They're using plastic parts instead of brass now. They're much more accurate. And in general, replacing meters improves the accuracy of the read. As meters age, they slow down, they underreport. So communities generally replace meters on a fairly regular schedule just to keep the readings as accurate as possible.
Sure. How much is the difference in what an older meter reads and a new meter? Does it actually pay to change the meter? I mean, is it extremely inaccurate, or
I'm going to defer to Ned.
Is it an expense that it's not mandated that we replace these? Is it?
No, it's not mandated, but it's basically a best management practice. I think right now we have on a 10 to 12 year replacement cycle across the city, and like I said, the new meters now are a plastic type meter, and they're getting away from the brass meters.
I think we've tested some meters. Occasionally an issue will come up with a homeowner and they'll ask us to test the meter, and the old ones are typically 5% or 5 to 10%.
The last couple that we tested have been 99% accurate.
But some of them
were, but they were, I mean, they weren't that old. There was a water bill issue and the person wanted to have it tested to make sure it was reading properly.
What was the VA?
I don't know offhand.
Gentlemen, when you speak, if you could speak closer to the microphone.
Okay.
Some examples where replacing the meter has been a big plus.
Can I ask, are these plastic meters more expensive than the older copper type?
I don't believe so. I can find that out for you.
So then all we're really talking about is in the meter replacement program, which you do anyway in order to keep all the infrastructure current, you're using plastic instead of copper.
You can't buy the old brass meters.
Brass, excuse me.
That's correct. This is what's coming out is current market.
Okay, thank you.
Hydrant replacement with the $30,000 from last year is still cooking along. Watershed improvements. We have a new senior environmental scientist on the staff of the DPW these days. Nicole Sanford has really been whipping that whole area of our domain into shape, and she has some projects that we think are very worthwhile that she wants to work on in the watershed areas. In this fiscal year, we put in a generator to allow us to run the pumps that lift water from the Mountain Street Reservoir up to the filtration plant. But of course, that's not a recurring expense in FY14.
Can you explain that? The Mountain Street pump station generator, is that any way connected to our vacuum priming system?
Not really. The Mountain Street Reservoir is below the filtration plant, whereas the Ryan Reservoir is above it. So Ryan can just flow right to the plant with no effort other than opening up the valve. Mountain Street needs to be pumped up the hill. There was a vacuum leak in the original system, and whenever we turned the pump off, the water would slide back down into the reservoir, and we had to prime it all over again. That's been solved. The other issue is to have a backup generator to run that pump when the power is out. The generator up in the plant was not sufficient to run both the plant and that that pump.
So would you categorize that as probably a design or engineering flaw or design flaw? I'm just curious. I mean, now we have a pump here, a generator.
You wouldn't get much pushback from me. I was a little disappointed that wasn't...
I remember it all coming about, and I was...
The whole generator at that plant has been a little bit of a disappointment.
And we don't get any reimbursement from anybody on anything on that?
Doesn't appear.
Have we tried? I mean, it just seems like it was a design flaw that we went ahead with.
I think it was a decision by the city at that point not to put a generator in, a backup power system. At that point, the plant had a full-size generator run everything, and Ryan was presumed to be the source of water that we're going to use on a predominant basis, so it would be gravity flow in. During this last event that we had, Hurricane Sandy, there was so much turbidity in Ryan Reservoir it couldn't be used, and we had to rely on the Mountain Street Reservoir, and realizing that if we had a power outage up there, we wouldn't have water for the city. So we moved forward with looking at a cost of putting in an emergency backup generator system so that it could power the low lift pump station to bring water up in a case of emergency.
Yep.
And that money was programmed into last year FY13 budget. We're still working on getting an engineer on board to actually design and come up and put out to bid the project to install that generator.
It seemed like we were plagued up there with some problems like leaking lagoons and the vacuum leak in the pipe, and now a pump vacuum primer, and now a generator. And so I'm just kind of curious, as we continue to spend, I think, more money without going after somebody that might have not quite designed this correctly or something.
The leaking lagoons were fixed free of charge.
Yeah.
They weren't a cost to the city. They were bored by the contractor. As far as the backup generator, it was never designed as part of the project. So I don't know how we can hold a contractor responsible for not installing it when it wasn't part of the design.
Wasn't part of the design.
It was not part of the design.
But you're right. There were some issues with the main generator.
Absolutely. Okay. I just wanted. Okay. And but that's spilt milk now, or let's call it
water over the dam, as we like to say in the water biz.
Yeah.
Watershed improvements. The granular activated carbon, basically we have a great big Brita filter up at that plant. It's a huge carbon filter. It's about $400,000 to change out the carbon. Our intention this year and moving forward is just to set aside an even amount of money every year so that when the time comes, we just take the money, buy the new carbon, instead of having 000, 400,000, 000, 400. So we're just trying to level it out. And then there's some reserve account amounts there. Proposed debt schedule, the well chlorination project was a proposed debt in FY13. The money has been spent. It's been borrowed and spent. And in FY14, it moves up into existing debt service. So the way the Munis system works, it shows as a proposed debt schedule in this year, and next year it appears to vanish because it's moved up into existing debt service. New facility design. This is for the new building at the Department of Public Works. We took out a note to pay for the design services of the architect, and my understanding is that we are not allowed to bond that money if we don't move into construction, which we're currently not doing. So we're required to repay that money over 3 years. The water department is going to come up with a quarter of the money, the sewer department a quarter of the money, general budget half of the money, and we will pay back that $800,000 over the next 3 fiscal years. And again, my understanding is that that's required because we haven't moved forward with that project. Finally, the Upper Roberts Meadow Dam, that show proposed debt schedule in this fiscal year of $108,000. In fact, as I explained earlier, we plan to pay cash for that. So that never happened. It's just a non-event.
Just really quick. The $800,000 is a band. It's not a bond. It's never been bonded.
Correct.
So
bond anticipation
bond it. It would be we would move into construction.
Right. So we're not allowed to bond design fees.
For 5 years, you have to move your band within 5 years to a bond. If you can't, you have to pay it off. So within the last 3 years, so that's what we're working on now is these 3 years.
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you.
So you work your way down. Total revenue requirement, actually, you'll notice decreases slightly in FY14. Unfortunately, we're also experiencing somewhat declining water use. So although the actual dollar amount that we're going to need in FY14 has gone down slightly, so is demand. So if you follow down, you'll see that our rate has to go up slightly from $5.40 to $5.47. This is an increase of 1.38%.
This is through individual meters that we get these figures, not this is metered water.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
What do we attribute the decline to?
The economy, people being more careful with their consumption, not watering lawns as much. We have summer outdoor watering bans. It's a little hard to say, really. We can only try to guess what it might be precisely. But accumulatively, across the city, people are using a little less water.
Jerry, wasn't the water ban quite a while? Couple of months.
Well, they've tied it to the Mill River. There's a stream gauge on the Mill River, which is a convenient local stream gauge that they can use to trigger when we have to have a water ban. The state selected that. Ironically, it has nothing to do with the watersheds for our reservoirs, but it triggers a water ban a little bit earlier than might, strictly speaking, be necessary, and it seems to leave it in place longer.
I also wanted to ask you about the reservoir up in Whately. And I remember when we had the ordinance in on buying Skibiski's property. Mm-hmm. And there was mentioning at that point, and I think maybe Councillor Chasey, if you can recall this, about doing some lumbering up in that area. Mm-hmm. Have you attempted to do that? And if you have, how much money have you made on that?
We have not. Nicole Sanford is taking over management. Some of you have been around for a while may recall that we had a forester who passed away. And it left a gap of, it's turned into like 10 years of really no active logging. We're just about to ramp up to get back to that. Historically, the logging operations went into a fund that was used for making land purchases.
Councilor, can I just kind of clarify what, or get straight what you were saying? The state triggers the water use ban, not
correct,
the city.
Yes.
So the state tells the city to enforce a water ban.
Right. This is we have permits for our reservoirs, for our drinking water system, for our wastewater systems, and one of the requirements somewhere in the permits, and that could speak to it more specifically, is that we enact ordinances for summer water bans during periods of low water.
So which state department is responsible for that?
That's the Department of Environmental Protection. that's a state DEP, as we call it, and it's part of our Water Management Act. It's a 5-year permit that we have with the state for withdrawal of water for the citizens of Northampton from our sources.
And it's linked to the Mill River?
Yes.
So they're basically asking us to be attentive to low water periods, drought periods, and to have some policy in place for dealing with those times. Okay, so basically 1.38% increase is what we're proposing. I should clarify that the Board of Public Works has not voted on this. This is a preview of what the board will be considering next week. I don't expect any changes, but this is an attempt to reach out and make sure all of you are somewhat knowledgeable about what's happening and where we appear to be going.
Could you repeat that again on the percentage?
It's a 1.38% increase over last year. For a typical household, we anticipate that their water bill for the year will be a little under $400.
No,
just the water or the water?
Just the water.
Now, given the context of this evening, you were witness to that and probably the other things and the other pressures that we're experiencing, and actually relative to the resolution that we just discussed, obviously, as you guys go forward and deliberate this, think of it in the context of the fact that what might be accounting for some of the reduced water flow might be the fact that not a lot of people built new homes, but they did retrofit their homes and their bathrooms and their kitchens with low flow systems. Those are people with some means to do that. And unfortunately, when we assess these fees, they are a de facto regressive tax system. They're not based on someone's ability to pay, they're based on usage. And someone who didn't necessarily have the money to retrofit, who's poorer, going to have to bear a greater brunt of increased costs of water consumption because they don't have the means to offset that. So, I'm sorry, Ned, you want to?
Starting about a year and a half ago, the department offered free water conservation kits to anyone in Northampton. Come to the DPW office and pick them up.
Thank you. That's excellent. That's very good. And I think that's a great idea to continue to promote that on the as we go forward talking about these things. I think, but the whole issue of fees, and this isn't on you guys, but it is something to consider as you're deliberating these things, is that, and I'm just asking, given the context, that as we're looking at increases everywhere, the onerous things tend to be the ones that aren't necessarily based on people's ability to pay. It's based on consumption or how their property's valued and so on and so forth. So someone on a fixed income isn't making the same percentage adjustment in order to pay for the water that they need, that it's a certain critical need. So I take your point. I appreciate that. Councillor has not spoken.
Just a quick Councilor clarification. Adams? You said the cost per household is approximately $400, mm-hmm. As opposed to approximately $395 presently. You said it would be a...
Yeah, it's a...
Okay, so about a $5 increase
exactly.
Per household per year? Yeah, okay.
All right, so I'll circle back to the rates in a few moments, but if I could, I'd like to move on to the sewer rate.
Before you do.
Yes.
In the water. I had a lot of questions on the water, but I don't want anybody to think that city that I have anywhere near any expertise. It's very complex. It's complicated to set water rates. I understand that. And I have no intention of trying to throw my hat into the ring to set water rates. That is not my intention. I just have some questions that I needed to have answered.
I'd be happy to.
I don't want to set the water rates.
Okay. Do you have thought there's a preamble to having some...
No, I just wanted to...
Oh, okay. Oh, no.
My questions... I just want to know.
Okay. No, your questions were welcome. Thank you. All right. Sewer enterprise. Again, in the top group, this is open the door in the morning, turn on the lights, and run the plant. Run the collection system. Run the plant. As you can see, we're spending a total of about $4.6 million in this fiscal year. We think it's going to go down slightly next year. That's sort of open up shop in the morning and run the place. Project-related costs are the elective projects that we do every year. Obviously, if a manhole collapses in a street, we have to fix that right away. That's up above in core operations. In project-related costs, we anticipate an increase in engineering design and permitting fees. That's the engineering services that go from 150 up to 300. Again, like in the water department, this is driven by the projects upcoming in the next few months. Sewer line replacement. $400,000 is the number we're trying to keep moving forward. $400,000 is, again, on the scale of what it took to do over North Street. The reason it jumps to $1.4 million in FY14 is we are going to build a new sewer interceptor essentially from the lower industrial park to the new Bradford Street pumping station. There's an in-ground pump right where the rail trail hits the railroad line behind McDonald's. If you think over on Bradford Street, there's a huge pumping station sunk into the ground there. We're basically going to make a dedicated line from the industrial park to that pump station. It will lift it up high enough that it can then enter go down Woodmont and get on the North Street and join up there. Again, we propose to use the undesignated fund balance to pay for this.
Woodbine. Did you say Woodlawn?
Woodmont.
Oh, okay, Woodmont. Thank you.
Woodmont. Yes.
Living on Woodmont, I'm just curious, is the road going to get any better, or is it just
no, we're going to try to ignore it if we can. Nothing will happen south of the pump station at this point.
That's Chapter 90.
Yeah. There will be reconstruction is on the upper parts of Bradford, going past the old Comcast building and up in that direction.
That's a private way there?
Not for long. We have voted to recommend the city council.
All right, we're off topic. I'm sorry.
Okay.
We're all good.
So replacement equipment at the wastewater treatment plant. That's new pumps, machinery. Replace vehicles. It's bumping from 15 to 40 because there's a specific truck they need to get for this coming fiscal year. We're trying to level that out just as we are in water. So it's just a simply set aside $25,000 or some amount every year. And if we need to build it up for a couple of years for a particular vehicle, that's the way we'll do it. Future capital projects. You'll notice it drops from 380 down to 60. That missing $320,000 was set aside to, in part, pay for this new interceptor from the industrial park, new sewer interceptor from the industrial park to the Bradford Street pump station. Control building. Mary, could I have that next slide? We have some corrosion and a little bit of leakage in some of the electrical pipes. Isn't that a riot?
Context.
I heard there was some seepage. So that's water streaming out of an electrical receptacle.
That's sewer. Yeah. That's sewer water.
No, this is groundwater. Oh. So this foundation was built in the late 60s, and it has conduit in the concrete running from one receptacle to the next, and all of the motor control wiring also is running through conduits in the concrete.
That's not
right. Now, we've stopped using that receptacle. But groundwater has leaked into all of the conduit. It's corroded, and it's in terrible shape. What we propose to do is start from scratch up at the head end of the electrical panel and run all new conduit inside the building. So it'll be surface-mounted conduit. And this is in what's called the pump gallery. It's a room about this size with perhaps a dozen or more large pumps, and they pump sewage in and out of those big outdoor retention ponds. So the $340,000 is to completely redo that, going all the way back to the panel. There's one more picture here. And I believe that this has some live wiring in it. The wooden trough there is just to get the water over to a drain that's a few feet away.
I've actually toured this field. I've seen the water come through the.
Yeah, it's amazing.
The outlet. The place is in dire need of some substantial upgrades and a lot of work, and it's a pretty, I don't want to say caustic or toxic place, but even the electric paneling appears to rot off of the walls and is switching and.
And with the whine of the motors in this pump gallery, you can't hear yourself think.
Yeah.
We've been told, in our estimation, this pump gallery is not a portion of the plant that's likely to ever change. There's so many pipes coming and going from the outdoor tanks to this spot, it's unlikely to ever become an obsolete location. So improving the electrical service to these pumps, the pumps will come and go, but these pipes aren't going anywhere. So we judge that improving the electrical service in this room is a worthwhile long-term project. Future capital parts, control building, communication upgrades. This is, we have about a half a dozen pump stations, like the one we just mentioned on Bradford Street, around the city. These are in low spots where we can't gravity feed the sewage all the way to the plant, or we're trying to get one line to mate with another line and there's an elevation difference, or going downhill has brought us down so deep that it's just not practical to keep digging down, even though it might work if we could. So there are about a half a dozen of these pump stations. We're currently using antiquated dialers. We get inconsistent alarms. Sometimes we don't get an alarm when we should, or we get an alarm when there's no problem. You may recall that last year we had a alarm failure at the wastewater treatment plant that wound up costing us about $120,000, not entirely related to the alarm, but we didn't get the call. Pumps were flooded. There was quite a bit of damage.
Did we ever, was there any compensation, anything from anybody on that?
Not
or did
that
we pay for that out of our pocket?
Not that I know of.
So insurance.
Insurance. All $10,000 was covered by insurance.
Was it our insurance or somebody else's insurance?
I think it was ours.
It was our insurance. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
And then finally, there are multiple buildings at the wastewater treatment plant, and there's a problem with intercoms between the buildings. Again, this is almost 50-year-old equipment that's not working very well. So we propose to improve the alarm systems and the intercom within the wastewater treatment plant. As with water, if you go down to the proposed debt schedule, first of all, there's we're working on a comprehensive report for the wastewater infrastructure. I'll talk about that in a moment. New facility design. This is the, again, to pay off the bond anticipation note. And the industrial park sewer line replacement, again, that $90,000 there, that's a borrowing that did not occur. We decided subsequently to pay out of the undesignated fund balance for that project. So total, if you work your way down to the actual revenue requirement, you can see that, again, it went down slightly. We have to adjust the rate up a little bit from $5.80 to $5.97. It's a 2.96% increase.
Can I ask what it... what's this fund balance transfer that didn't happen last year and is going to happen in the next fiscal year? 1.16?
That's the $1 million for the interceptor from the industrial park to that Bradford Street pumping station. It shows up above in sewer line replacement. The 400 in FY13 becomes 1.4. And then down here, the fund balance transfer is taking money from the undesignated fund balance.
Okay, which is not on the, this is all a cash flow.
Yeah.
Right.
The MUNA system is, it just twists your head around.
Right.
As I said earlier, what we're attempting to do here with this slightly non-standard format is make it a little easier to see the moving parts.
So what's going on, I'm sorry to interrupt, what's going on here is that there's a undesignated fund balance that you're transferring from in order to save on a rate increase? Is that basically what it looks like?
Yeah. Moody's recommends that we keep 266 days of operating capital in reserve. We have met that requirement. The numbers for the water enterprise fund are come more readily to mind, but we have, let me see if I get that right. No, I think it's the sewer. We have approximately $3.1 million in the various fund balances. That includes capital reserve and undesignated fund balance. Moody's suggests that we keep about 1.3 always on hand. So we have a surplus of a little less than $2 million above and beyond Moody's recommendation. We're proposing to take a little over $1 million of that excess, if you will, and use it for the sewer line interceptor. And
I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt. This.
No, I guess that's all I got.
Does the mayor support this fund balance transfer?
I haven't discussed it with him. We build it up. Again, our thought is that these projects in the neighborhood of $1 million are good candidates to see if we can save up a little bit of money and just pay cash. We did the math the other day, and if we borrowed the money for the sewer interceptor, we would pay eventually $214,000 in interest. It's a conversation we could have, but it seems like that.
All right, yeah, thank you.
We like.
Councilor LeBarge, do you have a question?
Yes, thank you. Terry, I just want to go back to the water.
Sure.
On it, because I heard about a $5 increase for the year, but on the bottom of the page, it is saying that in the year 2014, the average yearly bill individual is $186.15.
Correct. The increase, the line above that is $2.53.
Quarterly. Is it quarterly?
No, annual.
Annual?
Annual. And so we figure in an average household, you have about a little over 2.1 people per household or persons per household. So that would be, you know, about $5.40 annually for this hypothetical 2.1 person household. That's the increase.
Okay. So if you had a household of four or five?
If you had four or five people, in that case, you would have about a $10 increase.
Thank you very much.
And finally, the $2 million surplus over Moody's recommendation.
Back in the sewer.
Yes. And yeah, I'm desperately hoping we move forward here. So, but,
okay. Oh, all right. Yes. So you're getting us back on track. Thank you very much.
I have a question about that, though. I mean, that's actually an enviable position, obviously. I think if you look at other departments in the city, that's pretty enviable that you got this $2 million buffer over what Moody's recommends for a good bond rating, which allows you to borrow. Does Moody's look upon that and give you an extra bump in your rating consequently, or is this actually just...
I don't believe it does.
It's just a good comfort zone.
Well, the intention is... The thing about public works projects, water and sewer, is these are really expensive.
Right.
And they have a timeline that's measured in generations. I mean, these are big projects that last for decades, and they're not the sort of thing we can pay for just out of simple cash flow. We have to accumulate a little bit of money, spend it, or else we wind up borrowing for everything, we're trying to avoid.
You understand the challenge, of course, is on the political side, this is trying to make the case to constituents and fee payers that you know, my concern is this being interpreted as accumulated wealth, or some people may say, why couldn't you use that to offset an increase on fees?
I believe we have.
They are.
Yeah, we're using over $1 million out of each fund
No, I agree. I understand that, yes. But I mean, say, how could I make a case to a constituent by saying there will be a fee increase for your water rates? Your water rates are going to go up by a small amount, a comparatively small amount, but on top, when you factor in everything else that we're talking about here, the other pressures.
Let me move to the next section of what I was going to say, and
sure.
I'm happy to circle back, but it
sure,
may address some of that.
That's great. No, if you, yeah, thank you.
Okay, so how do these rates compare? We don't set our rates based on polling East Hampton, Amherst, and Haydenville and saying, what do you charge? We'll charge that too. It's driven by projects and needs that we have here in Northampton. But it's an interesting question. How do they compare? Several years ago, the legislature established a Water Infrastructure Finance Commission to look at funding needs for water and sewer infrastructure across the state. Among other things, in the report they issued early last year, they made recommendations for target water and sewer rates. They recommended that communities set a target of 1.25% of the median household income for the water rate and for the sewer rate.
Both. Water is 1.25,
yeah,
sewer is
2.5 total. I can't find a definitive figure for the median household income in Northampton, but it appears to be around $50,000 per household per year. Too high, you think? Too low?
No, it's...
That's about right.
I don't know about that.
Yeah, I think that's about
median
right.
Income.
Yeah. So based on that, and given the new water rates, the 2014 water rates, if they are approved by the Board of Public Works, our new water rate would amount to 0.78% of the household median income, less than 0.75%. Again, the target was 1.25%. So we're well under the target. Sewer rate would come to 0.85%, a little more, but still in the range of 0.8%, well below the target again of 1.25. As another way of looking at it, tie and bond in 2010, presumably when rates were a little lower, did a survey across the entire Commonwealth, and they found that the average water bill per household was $470. And we're talking about 391 here in Northampton for this year. Our rate is below the average for the state, and yet I would submit that our water infrastructure is first class. We have a basically brand new filtration plant, and our reservoirs are incredible. It's just an amazing asset, and most communities don't have anything close to what we have. Yet our water rate is well below the average. If you look at the sewer bill, the average in 2010, according to tie and bond, was $638 per household. We're proposing $426. So I think by both measures, as a percent of median income, or just how do we compare, we have very reasonable rates.
And so there's 2.1 persons per household. Is that what we...
That's... I have to admit, I was given.
No, it could be correct because it fits into play because the socioeconomic spreadsheet from the Division of Local Services says that the average income per capita per person is $24,600.
Okay.
So it does fit.
So 50 sounds
pretty much reasonable. Into the. Into the schedule, so it is right. It's right on. I think 50,000. I think you're right. You know, we talked about the 3.1 million, and we have, like, it's not 2 million. It was $1.5 million over.
Yeah.
Over 2 million.
1.6.
We keep in mind, too, that if we take any money out of it, if we kept it at $1.6 million, needed some money, we took that money out of there, then we would fall below what Moody's said we were supposed to have. Is that what you're saying?
Well, I'm saying if we were rigorous about staying right around where Moody's recommends we stay, then we would never accumulate any money for a project. None of these projects are the sort of things you whip out your little check and write a check for.
That's
so
the
we're
point.
Trying to build it up, spend it down, build it up, spend
That's
it down.
That's the point I want to stress. So I don't really believe that there is any extra money in there because we need, I mean, if you drew on the 1.6 or whatever the heck Moody says, we would fall way below it.
Yeah, or we...
To do a project.
We would be, right.
So it's not like there's a load of money in here, and it's not, so on the political side, it's not as though you're hoarding funds, because you're going to use that money to go forward.
Oh, yeah, okay. We've got a surplus so we can tackle a project.
Yeah, so I want to make that point very clear. There's no hoarding of money in the enterprise fund. Okay, thank you.
Councilor Freeman-Davis.
Yeah, I agree with Councilor Tacey on this. I'm actually at, you know, I'm surprised that the percent increase is lower. I was expecting the almost double digit increase that had been discussed a few years ago, and bracing for that, and I'm a little surprised that it's not larger.
Well, the final part of my presentation, if I haven't driven you crazy by taking so long, is I'd like to speak to that.
Okay.
We'll shut up and let you talk for a while.
Okay, so that's a snapshot of this coming year. This is a somewhat, I don't know if I say a unique year, but part of the reason that there's nothing going on with the rate is because in a way there's nothing going on with the infrastructures of these two systems. In both the case of the water system and the wastewater system, we're in the middle of major comprehensive engineering studies of our infrastructure. How many miles of 8-inch pipe? How many miles of 10-inch pipe? How many miles of 12-inch pipe? What's the age of the pipe? What's the anticipated lifespan of the pipe? Can we meet fire flows around the city with the water system? What strategies should we pursue with our aging wastewater treatment plant that's almost 50 years old? What's our way forward with this? We're looking to these reports to give us a sense of priorities, a sense of perspective on how the different pieces in our systems made up. We're looking for deficiencies. We're looking for locations where we really need to get busy and do some maintenance work or outright replacement work. In each case, we don't have the information yet. The water system report is available to the engineering staff at this moment in draft form. We anticipate the final report might be out in May, May-ish. The wastewater report won't be till later in the year, sometime this fall, I believe. We can see big things coming. GZA, the company that studies the dams for us, has identified millions of dollars worth of work they think we should consider doing on the dams. We have two lines bringing water from the reservoirs into the city. One's relatively new, about the age of the Rhine Reservoir. The other one goes back over 100 years, and it's had some breaks lately. If anything happened to the 36-inch line coming into the city, we would really need the 20-inch line. It's our only defense, our only backup. At some point, we're going to have to think about either rebuilding that 20-inch line or replacing it. We think it's prudent to at least consider having a duplicate feed from the reservoirs to the city.
What is the material of that line?
20 inches of
cast iron.
20 inches cast iron, and the 36 is ductile iron.
The 20 inches is
cast
iron, and what was the other size of the one?
36.
36 inch is ductile iron.
That's correct.
And then, for example, we know that out in the Rhine Road area, we should consider a storage tank so we can maintain fire flows. We have enough pressure out there to feed the residences, but not in the case of a major fire. In the wastewater treatment plant, it's almost 50 years old. There's no end of places where we could spend money there. And also our NPDES permit, our permit to discharge into the Connecticut River, is going to come out this fall, and we anticipate they're going to push us a little bit as far as upgrades and improving the product that we're releasing into the river. So we have a lot of upcoming projects. We just don't know how to prioritize them exactly. And we understand that we're probably going to have to begin looking across the whole spectrum of stormwater, drinking water, wastewater, and staggering them so they... It's no good to say, we'll work on this one, all simultaneously. these projects begin to become large enough that I think we have to think about staggering them like that so that we don't have two major projects hitting simultaneously, even though they might be in different areas of our domain.
Are we have really had to change the way through regulation on how we work on our AC water mains in the city. They've really, and do we anticipate having to replace, well, I think we have, was there 5 miles of AC?
Asbestos concrete.
Yeah. I believe there's probably closer to 40 to 50 miles of it in the city.
In the city. Mm-hmm. So, and at some point, we know there is some grumblings in the AWW that they're going to talk about replacing this.
There's been no formal regulations to say we have. Some communities have opted to take out their AC pipe that's in the ground.
Yeah. But the way that we maintain it now, the way that we address breaks is completely different and is more costly than it used to be.
Absolutely.
Could you just go through it for a second?
Sure. People have to wear protective respiratory gear now when they're cutting it and working on it. Has to be double bagged, has to go to a line landfill, can't be left in the ground in place like it used to be. So regulations have changed.
Yeah. So it is much more costly to work on AC than it ever was before.
That's correct.
Okay. So just to wrap up quickly, my point is that we're waiting for these asset management reports, and we think that will help us moving forward to make a better roadmap for how we will tackle projects and to begin to prioritize across the different disciplines which one ought to be first. I don't think it's enough to simply say this is next for water. We have to say also this is next for water, but we're doing this over on the sewer side. Let's move that back 2 years and begin to think of it that way. In an attempt to slow down this train of expense, or at least spread it out. That's all I have for you tonight.
Come on.
All right. I got a couple more things.
Can you tell me what the rate, what you said the rate was for water as a percent of median income again? It was 0.7 or something like that?
Water is 0.78.
0.78%.
Yes, if you assume a $50,000 median household income.
So I really want to thank you for coming forward today and making this presentation. I know it was trying because it was almost 50 minutes, but I think that the board is offering a public view of your thinking, of your budget, and of the rate, the possible rate, and the reasoning behind it. I really appreciate that. I think it will be required for the stormwater sure. fund, and I also I hope that the residents of Northampton saw this and will have a chance to watch it, because these two services are really essential. So these are the essential services that separate a second world country from a third world country. And if you think back about basically one and a half percent of the city's median income is devoted to an almost unbelievable benefit, to be able to push a button to get clean water and then push another button to get to take your dirty refuse away. It's an unbelievable service that is way more valuable than what we're paying. And I really appreciate your time tonight.
If I could just say ever so quickly, I've been on the Board of Public Works for about 17 years or so. I have to admit, it's really stunning to think that water commissioners back in the 1800s were buying farmers' fields out in Haydenville and West Whately, thinking, you know, that would be a good spot for a dam and a reservoir, and we're going to need this water. So they were looking ahead 130 years ago to things that we really need today and are using constantly today. So it just makes you think, man, you got to be looking way down the road about this stuff.
And Terry, I'd like to add to what Councilman Daniel said. I think this is in the process. I'd like to commend the DPW and the BPW both for bringing these conversations more to the public. Now, I understand that it requires a certain amount of patience to, one, present, and then also to hear, and that it's pretty complicated, but the fact is it's, you know, one of the things that the DPW always suffers from, as I said, is essentially it's almost their job to make this invisible and consequently unappreciated. And so consequently also, the public gets frustrated with the associated costs. And I think it's, I really appreciate the time that you guys have invested in this and you continue to invest in expanding and promoting the public conversation about these things. And that's, and that you have my—
Thank you, and I'll pass that along to everybody.
I wish you would. Thank you so much. Are there any more questions?
I just want to thank you again.
Sure.
And I can't say it enough, that for 60 years or so, or 70 years after our water system in the city was built, our water rates only went up 1%, 0.5%, sometimes 2%. And it, so in 2002, when the water rates jumped 22.5% because we had to build a filtration plant. So the water rates and sewer rates have been a hot button politically. I don't, it doesn't bother me politically at all, one way or another. But 22.5%, and then it continued 9% here and every year beyond that, makes it well over 100% that your water rate has gone up. But there's a reason for it. And I want to thank you and everybody for putting this together for
thank
us.
Councilor Barr.
After this presentation, are you going to be doing another one, possibly? Like maybe at JFK?
Not on this topic.
He's here all night.
We will vote on setting the water and sewer rates this coming Wednesday at the Board of Public Works. Our meeting is at 5:30. And
will you do a presentation like this?
The board has been working on this. We met Wednesday morning at 7:30. I mean, we've been working on there. Yes, I guess that's yesterday morning. We've been working on this for weeks. We sometimes have two or three people attending our meetings. We don't get quite the attention that you people get.
Well, thank
you. We should be meeting at 7:30 in the morning.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Terry. I appreciate your time. Ed, thank you.
Thank you for your time tonight.
Thank you. Jim, thank you for your time, too. On a hard chair.
You guys are welcome to stay. We got more to do.
We have a break, please. Jesse, break.
Right, okay.
President.
Can we have a break?
Is a call for a break? Recess for 7 minutes.
Thank you.
And we're back. This is City Council meeting for March 21st, 2013. Coming out of recess. The council accept a motion for acceptance of the minutes.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Well done. Okay. I'm
going streets. To,
with the council's permission, move up the an ordinance because we only have one person in the audience right now who will otherwise literally die of boredom. You have to endure the point this comes up on the agenda item, and it's for Fred Contrada, who's on deadline for this hot story. Upon the recommendation of the Police Department and the Committee on Public Safety, is an ordinance of the City of Northampton, Massachusetts, providing the Code of Ordinances, Chapter 312, be amended by adding Article, oh, this is a Roman numeral, this, Article 14, Vendors, Section 1 of said code, providing permitting of ice cream trucks. Be it ordained by the City Council of the City of Northampton and the City Council, some blah, 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 the chapter that, the Chapter 312, Article 14, Vendors, Section 1 of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Northampton, Massachusetts, be added so that such section shall be as follows. Add a pursuant to 520 CMR, okay, 15, the Massachusetts Department of Public Safety requires each municipality to issue permits to persons engaging in ice cream vending for the purpose of this ordinance, the following definition shall apply. Ice cream, any frozen dairy or frozen water-based food product. Ice cream truck, any motor vehicle used for selling, displaying, or offering to sell ice cream. Ice cream truck vending, the selling, displaying, or I'm going to collapse. or offering to sell ice cream or any other prepackaged food product from an ice cream truck. Ice cream truck vendor and operator? Well, guess, because I'm not going to read it. I'll let your imagination run wild. No person shall engage in ice cream truck vending within the City of Northampton unless the applicant has been issued a valid permit to do so by the chief of police or his designee. Said permit shall only be valid within use of the city limits. With use within the city limits, a separate permit is required for every person who engages in ice cream truck vending operations. All permits shall be conspicuously displayed and clearly visible on the windshield dash of any ice cream truck operated on from which an ice cream or any prepackaged food product is sold.
Move to approve. Second it.
Oh, wait.
Yeah, you have a second page. A lot of the second page.
Yeah.
I can waive the reading.
Please do.
Reading, or does is it?
All right. Waiver sufficient.
You think? Do you think we understand the order? And the
I think we can waive the
okay. Move to waive the reading.
Required valid licenses.
Right.
The okay. The things that you would expect from an ice cream truck and an ice cream truck vendor as well.
Move to approve.
Second.
Second it.
Any discussion?
I'll just summarize what was on that, what I think are the important parts of the section. It's just, you pay $50 permit. Sex offenders are, of course, not eligible in any situation, and they will do a background check on other applicants, and for cause, the police department can deny applicants, and there is a right to appeal to the public safety committee, and that's the appellate process. That's really what the second page is in sum.
Thank you, Councilor Connolly.
And just to piggyback on Councilor Adams' comments, it's really, when this was presented at public safety, it's just a matter of state law now.
Mm-hmm.
Every city and town needs to adopt this policy or somewhat similar.
As Councilor Murphy noted, an unfunded mandate from the state. Councilor LaBarge.
So this is something new through the state now, which before it did not have Cori checks, correct?
I don't know if it had Cori checks or not, but the fact that it's now a state authority that the state requires us to do it and has the police chief or his designee authorize licensing for the fleets of ice cream trucks that we see cluttering our neighborhoods with. Okay. Brandishing products to the lactose intolerant.
Okay. Thank you.
Sorry. Getting a little too flip.
Aye.
My apologies. And there's been a request for two readings.
Suspend rule.
Okay.
Second.
We have to vote on the first motion.
Okay.
So all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Suspend rule 14.
And the roll call.
Motion to suspend rules.
Second.
Roll call.
We need a roll call?
Why?
We can request a roll call.
Oh,
right.
That's true.
Oh, you're requesting. I'm sorry. I thought you were saying it was required.
Oh, it's by an ordinance.
Oh, it's roll call by ordinance.
Oh.
We need our super.
That's right.
All right, so let's go back. We're going back before back to the first motion and calling for the roll on the first motion.
Yes.
Yes.
Aye.
Yes.
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 Now, there's a motion to suspend rules, which does not require a roll call vote.
All second.
Favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed?
Move second reading.
Second.
There's a motion for the second reading. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We don't need a roll call on the second reading?
Yep. Now that was just.
Now we have to.
We're on the floor. I'm sorry. It's okay. Roll call for the second reading, please. Yes.
Aye.
Yes.
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 There you go, Fred, Chad. We're sitting around for that. Yeah, but have a good night.
Put in for your licenses early.
Okay, now back to the reports of the committees.
Petitions?
Move to approve.
I'm sorry.
You done the petitions?
Yes.
On the streets.
On the streets. But first we'll do the reports of committees.
Move to approve.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. It's a petition for street acceptance.
Refer.
No, we got to send them to Board of Public Works.
It's a refer, right?
A second. Hang on a second.
Refer.
All right, refer them out.
Okay, so I'm going to make a motion that that our two reports from committees, we move as a group.
Second.
All right, okay, hang on a second. We're doing catch up here.
Exactly.
That's right.
That's right.
Well, will we refer them as a group?
Second.
All those in favor of moving the petitions as a group?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you, Mary.
Thank you, Mary. Now the minutes.
Yeah.
And there was a motion.
I'd like to move the Committee on Public Safety and the Committee on Social Services reports from February as a group.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Thank you all.
You're welcome.
And I'd like to move the reappointment of Dr. Joanne Levin to the Board of Health.
Second.
Aye.
Marianne?
Yes. This is a reappointment, and I think it is supposed to go to appointments and evaluation, so I would like to suspend Rule 30, please.
Wait, second. Is that our rule now?
Oh, yes, sir.
Well, under the new rules, let's see if it is. The new rules, remember, they got renumbered, just so we're clear. We don't want to suspend
the wrong reference rule. To committee still 30.
Yeah. Excellent. Yeah. That's great.
And it was moved and seconded.
Perfect. All those in favor of suspending Rule 30?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. So the Councilor, yours was originally a motion to refer.
I renew that motion.
Second.
No, I'm sorry. I was moving to approve, so I renew that motion.
Okay. So the motion is to approve, and there's a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you. This is on second reading. Do you want me to waive the reading? This is for the Florence Grammar School historical, the architectural, the historical restriction. Thank you for the Florence Grammar School.
Move to approve.
Second.
Point of order. The motion seconded.
Can I get a clarification from Councillor Murphy? are you writing the RFP or reviewing it soon, like next?
The RFP will be presented at the ad hoc slash finance meeting next Tuesday. So it is my anticipation that committee will recommend that we surplus and sell the building, and then we'll, just after that, review and put forward the RFP language, and then it will come here so that we can put our stamp on it and start the process. It needs to come to council, but that will happen. And as we mentioned before, the mayor has committed to a process where the historic restriction would only be put in place if the lucky high bidder wanted to do business with the restriction. It permits some things, but so does the zoning. So the mayor's indicated that he'd like to get the best bidder and is not going to impose the historic restriction unless the high bidder that we want to do business with wants it.
And that's still assuming the vote to surplus happens.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna move that we postpone this until the next meeting, just so it happens after the actual vote to surplus.
There's a motion to postpone. Is there a second?
I would second that.
Councilor Murphy seconds it. Do you want to discuss it?
Just that's my reasoning.
Yeah, it doesn't. There's no super hurry for it. I mean, Mr. Fiden was at one level concerned only that the State Historic Commission, who reviews these things, you know, who knows how long it'll take them to do it, but who knows if the mayor's even going to use it anyway. So I don't think it really, if six of one, half a dozen the other, I don't think it matters if we wait another week or another meeting or two.
Anticipating the postponement to the next meeting probably.
It's not unreasonable.
All those in favor of postponement?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay. This is on first reading. This is, there's been a request for readings on this, but upon the recommendation of Mayor David Narkowitz and Councilor Marianne LaBarge, Northampton City of Northampton providing the Board of Ordinance. I'm just going to say this is to establish the Disabilities Commission, and as you heard in public comment, essentially what that effectively does, it allows current alternates to now function as voting members, and it conforms the Mass General Law. Unless you want me to read these.
No, move first reading.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? No? All those in favor? I'm sorry. It's an ordinance. Yep. Roll call, please.
Councilor Raymond Daniels?
Aye.
Councilor Barge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Schwartz?
Yes.
Councilor Casey?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor
Kline?
Yes.
Yes.
I would like to request a second reading, please.
Would you like to suspend
rule 14?
Suspend rule 14.
All those in favor of suspending rules?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Is there a motion for second reading?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Roll call. I know we got to get used to this.
I'm sorry. Roll call, please.
Councilor Barge?
Yes.
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 Aye.
Thank you. We can go on.
You got a notion there?
I got an idea.
Okay. Now, this is also in first reading. This is about the Community Preservation Committee and the powers and duties. And amended language. Is it the council's pleasure that I read this, or would you prefer that I waive reading?
Waive reading.
Waive it.
Okay. Your motion.
I move approval.
Second it.
Any discussion, Councilor Freeman Daniels?
Yeah, this one. as well as the previous order ordinance and one coming up later, number 8, they're all in this interim period where we're, I don't know how many councilors are familiar with this, but this is, we're in this period where the council can still pass ordinance relating to multiple member bodies in the city. But those that ordinance will get superseded by administrative order written by the mayor. Mm-hmm. So the interim period is we're in it. So we can run amok until the mayor writes an administrative order, and then we have to change.
Comes in 2014.
Well, take the
September,
tour.
I believe. That's his deadline. Yeah, that's his deadline.
And also, just by the way, on this, it seems to be just there's some house cleaning language.
It's house cleaning language, giving the authority of the city council, striking the mayor's name or the reference to the mayor. And the, mm-hmm. All those in favor? Aye.
Roll call.
Damn.
I know.
Roll call, please.
Yes.
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 Aye.
I'm intent on getting Councilor Murphy out of here before we have to.
Before he croaks.
I was going to say, my CPR skills are not up to snuff. Take these as a group.
Yes.
So I move ordinance 4 through 7 as a group.
Second.
Which ones?
4 through 7.
4 through 7. That's vehicle charging stations, parking meter locations and regulations, yep. On-street parking meter zones, and off-street parking areas. Okay. This is in first reading.
Got it.
Councilor Freeman, and has been seconded. Councilor Freeman Daniels.
Thank you. This came out of the Transportation and Parking Commission, which was trying to deal with the electric charging stations for cars, for electric cars that we have now due to a federal grant in the city. And we tried to figure out exactly how to proceed, and staff wrote this, wrote these changes, and they brought it before the Transportation Parking Commission, and it really did capture, I think, a lot of what the commission was looking for, and I hope what a lot of the council, what the majority of the councilors here are looking for, which is that in zones where in areas where you have to pay to park now, you will also have to pay while you're filling up your electric car. In areas where there is no fee for parking, obviously there's not going to be any fee for parking and filling up your car. One caveat, though, for the unwary is that if your car, you can't park in an electrovoltaic or a charging station, not an electrovoltaic, excuse me, an electric charging station for longer than your car is necessary for it to be charged. It's the equivalent of sort of parking your car at the gas station pump and then, you know, walking and doing the rest of your shopping. So that's to encourage turnover. We don't have unlimited number of spots, unlimited charging stations. It's to encourage people to park their car, fill it up, or get as close as they can to filling it up. And then if they want to stay around Northampton, to move it, to allow for other electric cars to take their place.
Is there a way of knowing whether it's filled up?
Or there's a light.
Fully charged?
There's
a light on the meter. Good.
There's an external light that can be viewed by a parking enforcement officer.
Awesome.
So it's a great first step, because our previous first step had gas cars occupying the spaces, because they oftentimes will double as 15-minute spaces or as just regular parking spaces inside the garage. So it's a very good first step. I think that some people might become upset if they park their car there for a long time and they come back and it's ticketed because their car's full up. But that they're going to have to to vacate the spot once, because it is like a gas pump, you know, it's, no one parks their car at a gas pump, so we're asking electric car people who are getting free electricity from the city not to park their car there past the charging time.
There's also a time, tonight at 6 o'clock when I arrived here, there was two gasoline-powered cars in the both of the electric charging stations at the bottom of Crafts Avenue. So we know this is going to end up being tweaked somehow one way or another, but even at night, people need to recharge their cars. So if you're not putting money in a meter at a time, it still should be regulated, and there still should be some enforcement action. Thank you.
Any other discussion on these? All right, roll call, please. Thought I was going to do it, right? Yeah, I watched you stare at me. That's why I had.
Yes.
Councilor Schwartz?
Yes.
Councilor Tracy?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor
Yes.
Aye.
Yes.
Is there a motion to suspend rules?
Yeah, I move to suspend the two readings rule.
Second it.
14?
Yeah.
The second. All those in favor of suspending rules?
Aye.
Is there a motion for the second reading?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Roll call.
Yes.
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 All right. So if you have an electric ice cream vending truck, we've got you so covered tonight. It's crazy.
I know.
We moved them as a group. This is up to number 8 here. This is an ordinance relative to public comment. This is presented. This is upon the recommendation of Councilor Jesse M. Adams, Councilor William H. Dwight, and Councilor Owen Freeman Daniels. This is an ordinance of the City of Northampton providing that the Code of Ordinances of the City of Northampton be amended by adding a section to be numbered 23 of said code and providing that public comment be ordained by the City Council of the City of Northampton, the City Council assembled as follows, that section 23 of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Northampton, Massachusetts be added so that such section shall read as follows. All multiple member bodies as defined in Article 1-715 of the Charter shall allow individual members of the public to address the body at the start of each regular meeting on any matter within the body's purview. Individuals wishing to speak must be recognized by the presiding officer and must state their name and address. The body may determine rules to facilitate this ordinance, including the length of time that will be allowed to provided for public comment and the length of time that each individual will be allowed to address the body. This ordinance shall not apply to any public hearing held by any multiple member body in which the body acts in a quasi-judicial role and takes testimony and other evidence from the public, but all other business of that same body shall be subject to this ordinance. Nothing in this ordinance shall be construed to require or preclude a public comment period at the beginning of a special meeting of multiple member of a multiple member body.
Move to approve.
Second. Councilor Adams, you want to speak to this?
Yeah, this ordinance, I drafted this. It's in the spirit of best practices. The purpose is to encourage citizen inclusion and to empower citizens by mandating the opportunity to give them to speak to whatever body's making a decision that they appear before. Again, it's for citizen engagement and empowerment, and I think the majority of committees, if not the vast majority, are already in compliance, so that it's not too much of a burden, no burden for those committees. But not all committees follow this rule all the time as a matter of custom. So now, if this passes, though, it'll be mandated, which I think will go a good ways to improve the openness of government. Also, as similar to what Councilor Freeman Daniels pointed out earlier, this ordinance will be, when the mayor supersedes the current multiple member bodies with administrative orders, this ordinance will not apply to those administrative orders because we can't draft and we can't by ordinance regulate the executive branch and the mayor's administrative orders. That's the purpose of this.
As Councilor Freeman Daniels said, we're running amok. Councilor Freeman Daniels.
Right. I support this because I do believe that it helps citizens who do want to put in a comment to a public body. It allows them to do it, especially if there's something on the agenda that they have a comment on. So I think it's good for social justice. But I also would urge the mayor, when he does redraft the administrative orders, that he include this in the multiple member bodies.
I'm sure he's paying attention. Send him a memo. Councilor Tacey.
Yeah. Nothing in this ordinance shall be construed to require or to preclude public comment at the beginning of the special meeting.
For multi-member bodies.
Yeah.
Which is, and Councilor Adams can speak to that.
Would you touch that a little bit?
Sure. Basically, it means that special meetings, this is not mandated for special meetings. It's basically gives the chair discretion when a special meeting is held to go ahead and follow this or not, but it doesn't, this ordinance does not mandate that public comment is required at special meetings. It's only optional, and that was at the suggestion of the city solicitor.
So the chair could say no public comment?
At special meetings, yes.
But at regular meetings of council established committees, they will be required to, mm-hmm. Unless the mayor deems otherwise by September 2014.
Okay. So it's only for the special meeting, beginning of a special meeting.
It's only for at special meetings that public comment is not mandated, but is only optional for the chair.
If it's not a hearing yeah. allows for public right. comment and requires, in fact.
Again, I just wanted to air it for,
right.
for everybody.
Right.
Okay.
This requires a roll call.
Yes.
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 Yes. Could I request that we could do a second reading on this, please?
You want to suspend rules?
Yes, I would like to suspend Rule 14.
Second.
Yep.
All those in favor of suspending rules?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Is there a motion for the second reading?
Yes, so moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Yes.
Yes.
Aye.
Yes.
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 Passed in two readings. All right, Carolyn.
Poor Carolyn. She'll be here at midnight.
Can we start signing those ordinance things now?
I mean, as he just,
two readings,
two readings, so to blow through those. Actually, I would accept for these upcoming, accept a motion to recognize Carolyn Mish.
So moved.
Make a motion to recognize Carolyn Mish.
All those in favor of recognizing
Carolyn? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. I recognize her.
All right. This is ordinance first reading that calling for the rezone parcels on East Hampton Road from BP to SR to GI to help fulfill the business park vision.
Okay, so pretty straightforward. I think you had a public comment earlier about this too, but I don't know if the screen is dark enough, but there's two parcels down on East Hampton Road. This is a storage place. So the first, there actually is three parcels. These two back up to each other, the former nursing home, and then this piece just north of that. And basically, as the ordinance spells out, it's really a mechanism to help facilitate economic development on the upland portion of these properties. This area has been zoned business park, except for all of this area is business park right now. And this little piece here is SR, which is consistent with all this backland here, which includes the golf course, which is also suburban residential. So the idea really is that the business park hasn't been able to develop as a unified sort of development scheme because there are multiple property owners within that, and the whole zoning was to try to create another sort of mini industrial park. but it hasn't worked out for the years it's been in place. So this is sort of a little step to facilitate some of that development and also include this building and the back land that really we don't anticipate that it'll ever be residential. It was a nursing home, then doggy daycare, and so it's it makes sense to sort of also include that in the packet, and the zoning across the way is general industrial too.
Where's the Wilson Plumbing and Heating shop?
It's farther down. I think it's.
Oh no! It's there. Oh, okay, I see it now. Yeah.
Okay.
And that no, that's not any part of this.
That's general industrial. This whole side is general industrial already.
Well, there's letters in that orange. I didn't see it. I thought it was just some orange shading in there. Now yeah. I see it.
No, this is the parcel that's business park to general industrial. These mm-hmm. are the two parcels that are special suburban residential to.
Which is the Raymond piece?
The bigger parcel right here.
Okay. Thank you.
Carolyn, so looking at the mapping that you have, mm-hmm. what we're actually doing is rezoning, I think it's called the doggy daycare, correct?
Right.
Which used to be what? A former nursing home
yeah.
and so forth. From residential to general industrial, correct?
Right.
Which will allow offices.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And knowing the site, there has not been any residential or anything going on there.
Right.
Correct? So what would happen is that this still could stay as a daycare, mm-hmm. as a doggy daycare, offices, what else could go in there?
Well, there are a number of uses that are allowed in the general industrial zone that, as you mentioned, back office, there's research and development, there's industrial development. So if you imagine all the businesses that are in the industrial park, any of those types of uses are allowed. There's some bookbinderies or that kind of thing, and actual manufacturing can go there as well. So the dog daycare is there by variance because it's not allowed in a suburban residential, but because it had been a commercial use before. So this really opens up more flexibility for the suburban residential parcel to transform into other uses as time changes and
so then changes. Looking at this, I think the importance of this is that there's a parcel, correct, that it's part of the business park that could be developed correctly.
Right. And so the issue before had been, so again, the business park, the requirements under business park is that you have to come in as a unit, and multiple property owners had to come together to decide to on a plan, extend sewer and roadway or driveway access. Rezoning this sort of pulls it out of that, but because there's a development agreement in place with the property owner, Raymond, that he will extend sewer and share that and create an easement for the properties to the north. So it effectively initiates that shared access and share infrastructure, sewer infrastructure, but it allows it to happen one parcel at a time.
Right, so if you look at this to me would be generating more jobs and taxes, correct?
We hope so.
What did you say the bigger piece was north of the Raymond?
Oh, this right here, Goldfarb owns this property.
And that's not included in this?
No.
And what would be the reasoning? I'm just curious.
Well, we haven't, it may come at some future date. We just haven't had the conversation with the property owner. This land also has a lot more wetlands, so we need to look more carefully. There are wetlands. The other piece that's made this difficult to develop is that there are some vital species there, certified vernal pools. We've done some habitat analysis. So it's not all of it's not developable. It really needs to be looked at more carefully. So we're doing this sort of in a staged approach, but it doesn't preclude another piece or another portion of that property, maybe not the entire thing, but maybe mm-hmm. you know, another little bit.
Is there any conversation about sewer?
Yes, from the idea would be to bring sewer up from East Hampton. and tie in, but have it so that both property owners have access to it. That's the development agreement that says that this property owner will share access and provide easements so that this property owner can both have roadway access or driveway access and share a driveway so that there's one curb cut to minimize traffic impacts on East Hampton Road, but also share sewage.
So the funding mechanism for a sewer is going to be borne by who?
The property owner.
The property owner.
Right.
And where's the East Hampton line there again, please?
It's right here where the parcel lines stop. So this is this must be where the bank is. It's not showing up on the.
So the other piece, right in there, now south of that, just down a little bit, right there.
That's suburban residential.
And there's nothing. There's no residential. Nothing in there. And that's all in Northampton.
Yes.
So are you saying that you'd like to make a map change on that parcel as well? Because I think it's too late at this point. We haven't gone through any of the process.
No, I was just wondering why it wasn't included. I thought maybe that whole stretch. I was kind of thinking the whole stretch was included, but I guess it's not.
No, not at this time.
Is that one?
But it's basically willing buy. We have a development agreement with Raymond, right. And that was the important piece that we didn't want to move it forward until we had some assurances that overall the planning goal of sharing services was still being maintained. Mm-hmm. So we've had that conversation. Like I said, it is entirely possible that at some future date we'll move.
Okay. So my question is, where does the sewer end there?
I couldn't tell you. The East Hampton sewer, I don't know where it ends. I don't know how far they'd have to pull it up.
Actually, the doggy daycare is connected to East Hampton. But
oh, they got connected?
They're connected to it.
Okay. So then it's not that far.
I guess my next question would be, is that sewer service in the street, is it adequate to handle a business park?
It's our understanding that yes. And I mean, this is, so the business park concept goes back, you know, more than 10 years. And over time, so initially the city looked at trying to get grants to extend sewer from Northampton. And there was conversations with East Hampton bringing it up as they started developing Route 10. But there have been studies to show that, yes, there's adequate sewer capacity in the East Hampton.
Yeah, I know there's adequate in East Hampton. I just wonder if there's adequate sewer capacity in the street right now, all the way to Doggy Daycare, to facilitate to use for a business park. Or will there be another construction project?
Yes, it's not going to be a, you know, we don't anticipate that it would be if there were another Coca-Cola plant, I don't know. I can't answer that. It would be hard to know what users would, create the maximum demand that would be acceptable for the system.
I intend to support this. I just trying to look down the line a little further and see if the city's going to be on the hook for a sewer main in that last stretch. That's all. Or would it all be on the developer?
No, it would be on the developer, at the developer's cost.
Okay.
Are there any other questions? Councilor Freeman-Dams.
Whether we change the zoning or not, the developer, the city won't, will or won't, it, that's a completely separate issue about whether the city will have to do sewer or not. I mean, the zoning is irrelevant to that.
Any other questions?
No.
Roll call?
Yes.
Yes.
Aye.
Yes.
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 Pass in first reading. Next up, this is regarding home occupation. Be amended to be consistent with the current home business classification. And count stays recognized. For any questions, I'll accept a motion.
Move to approve. Second it.
Okay. Any questions for Carolyn on this? Carolyn, do you want to actually give a brief overview first?
Which one is this one?
Yeah, it's a leftover piece of text that we didn't catch when we came through and made all the changes to home business several months ago, and so it's really just a cleanup. Yeah.
And you're going to be making additional changes to home business with the subsequent zoning package, am I right?
Right. Not to
home business, not home occupation. Right.
Right, because we're calling it home business now. Right. Sort of gotten rid of the occupation.
Sounds like a crime when you call it a home occupation. Councilor LaBarge.
Thank you. So this is just housekeeping. That's what we're doing. Okay. And it's deleting this section of the zoning?
Right.
Do you want two readings on this, Carolyn?
Whatever you feel. I mean, there's no hurry. No one's banging down the door saying, hey, why is this still in the ordinance? So whatever you guys are comfortable with.
It would be my preference if we could not to do it spread out in two readings.
Okay.
Roll call, please. Yes.
Aye.
Yes.
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 Okay. This is for the water supply protection, larger accessory structures allowed, addressing mistakes in the attached garage setbacks, relaxing photovoltaic structure standards. Is that the motion?
Move to approve.
Second. Hit it.
So, again, some of this is housekeeping in that we found some errors in the first time around in the table and didn't have the correct setbacks for detached structures. So this corrects and goes back to what is the standard throughout the city for detached structures versus attached garages and things. Also inserts a new text about the allowance for having slightly larger structures on your property depending on your lot size. And this is a move that we're going to be proposing in each of the residential districts as they come forward, because there have been some requests on the part of property owners who have 7-acre parcels or 10-acre parcels. They're still limited to 1,000 square foot a footprint for an accessory garage, same as in an in-town lot where you might have a 2,000 square foot lot. So it just allows a little bit more flexibility in the size of a garage or storage shed or something. And then in terms of the photovoltaic panels, this is sort of the next step forward in relaxing some of the regulations we just adopted for the entire city, the allowance for ground-mounted panels. And the planning board has found that there have been multiple requests by individual property owners to have ground-mounted solar arrays. And currently, no matter what size you are requesting, it requires a special permit. And now that the planning board's been able to see some of these, most of them are coming in as just providing energy or collecting energy for just that individual home. And so the idea is to allow those to move forward by right. But if you are generating more than what your home would need, then that would be the time at which you would trigger a special permit.
Well, what, of course, what many people do with solar is sell it back to the electrical company and get credit for that, essentially, and to offset their bills. So what are the guidelines in which?
Well, we're looking at, we're not going to get into, I should say, when a person applies for a permit, the idea is to say, you know, if you're sizing your panel to meet your need, there may be times where you have a little bit of extra. We're not going to get into that minutia. It's more about the
scale of
what you're putting on your parcel.
So whatever panels that are equivalent to providing power supply for that house, as opposed to putting up a massive array.
Exactly.
Got it.
Not sell it back, sell it to.
What's that?
Sell it to the grid.
You sell it back to the grid.
You sell it onto the grid.
Regardless, what you're saying is just that it's proportional to the house, essentially, for the house's electrical needs.
Right, and if you wanted to go more than that, then that would be what triggers the special permit, because the planning board would want to look at neighborhood context and all that.
They're doing an indoor growing operation or something that, for whatever purpose, hydroponics of some sort.
I was going to say I support this, but now I'm not sure what to say there. I support this change because I think it will greatly reduce the barriers to doing these solar panels. So I think that that is a great way to generate more electricity. And so I support this. I think we should vote on it.
Is that a call for?
No.
Calling a question?
No, no. No.
Is there any other discussion?
One quick question. I said the setbacks and the house. What triggers the permit on the size of the building? How small of a structure can you, like a storage shed, can you put on your property without needing a permit? Or how
I
big?
I believe it recently, in the last couple of years, went from 100 square feet to 200 square feet, but I'm not an expert on the building code, so I don't know, but I think it's in that range, 200 feet.
10 by 20 or something like that wouldn't require.
Right. We still look at it for zoning,
yeah,
to make sure that the setbacks are being met, but it doesn't, there is a bottom threshold under which you don't need a building permit.
Okay. And did the state set that or did we set that?
State set.
The building state. Code. It's building code, yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Councilor LaBarge.
Looking at this ordinance, what we're actually doing is cleaning up an error that was made last year, correct? And if you have a lot that's 1,000 square feet, a small lot, right, this also will help somebody who has a larger lot, correct?
Right. For accessory structures.
Exactly.
Correct. Yes.
Okay. And then also allowing, say, somebody with a smaller lot to be able to have the grounded mounted solar put in, correct?
Yes, and the setbacks would be the same as for any other detached accessory structure.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Call the roll, please.
Aye. Aye.
Yes.
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 Yes. Yes. Excuse me. This is an ordinance consistent with Sustainable Northampton Minimized Permit Review. Also add recording requirements.
So.
Waiver.
And thank you. And actually, is there a motion first? I'm sorry. To put this on the floor.
I move approval.
Okay, go ahead. Now you're welcome to go.
This is to. What we do often is when we're going in and making adjustments to sections, we look for other areas that need to be cleaned up or clarified. So that's what's going on here. The original impetus was twofold, essentially, is to require recording of the actual site plan that is submitted as part of an application and then is also part of the decision. Record those at the Registry of Deeds. Currently, just the decision itself is required to be recorded at the registry. And so, 1 or 2 years out, someone goes and does a search at the registry, and there's a reference to a plan, but the plan is nowhere to be found. So this really just sets a requirement that the plan that's the decision is based upon gets recorded. It also we took the opportunity to eliminate the site plan requirement for anything in the central business that's not a footprint expansion. So typically, anytime you've got more than 2,000 square feet of additional space, usually up is without a footprint expansion, it requires site plan approval. But Central Business Architecture Review also looks at those, and there's so much overlap in those instances where there's no footprint modification that Planning Board and Central Business Architecture Committee felt like that it was prudent to eliminate that overlap and review. So that's what that piece is. And then there's just cleaning up some text. This was modified in committee review to eliminate, based on the city solicitor's recommendation, the allowance for the staff to make a decision about the size of the plans being recorded, that it really should be part of the planning board review. So that's in front of you is the text change.
This is amended, by the way.
Right.
Mm-hmm. based on the city solicitor's recommendation. Any other questions?
Nope.
Yeah, I support this. I think it's great because it liberalizes economic development in central business, and also for members of the public who want to seek out the requirements regarding special permits or special permits and site plan.
Well, the next one relates to special permits.
Right, so
yes, I mean.
So yes, then it helps because they can see what those conditions were if they ever want to see if those conditions are being adhered to.
Any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Barnes?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Schwartz?
Yes.
Councilor Tacey?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Freeman?
Aye.
Next up, site plans approved with special permits to be recorded with a decision reading, and this is also as amended by the city solicitor.
Right, and this is, sorry.
We need a motion, thanks.
Move approval.
I can second it.
Okay.
Same discussion as before, only not it's really just focused on recording the plans that go along with the special permit decision.
Same support as before.
It's nicely abbreviated. Councilor LaBarge.
So what we're actually saying here, that this will require the property owners of getting a special permit?
If a property owner is doing a project that triggers a special permit, that applicant also has to submit a plan with their application to the planning board. This is a requirement that not only does the decision get recorded, but the plan upon which the decision is based is recorded together with that decision.
At the registry.
At the registry of deeds.
Correct. Okay.
That never happened before?
No.
Only subdivision.
Waive
for
reading.
Subdivisions, we require.
I'd like to waive reading of the.
There's been a motion to waive the reading.
Second.
All those in favor of waiving the reading? No.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right, then. Any other discussion on the motion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Schwartz?
Yes.
Councilor Tacey?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Doyle?
Yes.
Councilor Freeman?
Aye.
Councilor
yes.
We're getting there, folks. We're getting there.
We're getting there.
This one also is no recommendation out of Ed Lieu. And maybe we can ask Councilor Freeman Daniels to explain that one. We put it on the floor. Comes with a
me.
Well, if you want out of Ed Lieu, there was no recommendation, and there was positive recommendation, unanimous positive recommendation out of the planning board, and ordinance same thing, positive recommendation. excuse me, this is an ordinance to amend new non-conforming aspects to already existing non-conforming single or two-family homes be allowed by special permit consistent with recent court rulings on the matter. First reading, I'll accept a motion.
So moved. Second it.
Carolyn, you want to, and then we'll
yes.
Let Councilor Freeman Daniels explain the absence of a recommendation out of Ed.
So, this is a complicated section under state statute as well as our local ordinance. Deals with pre-existing non-conforming lots or structures. And in Northampton and across the Commonwealth, there are lots of those that exist. Let me take a little step back and just explain the Zoning Board of Appeals jurisdiction and role. Zoning Board of Appeals issues three types of permits. One of them is called what we call in our zoning ordinance a finding. And that's issued under Section 9, non-conformities. The Zoning Board evaluates, for example, if there's a single-family house that has a non-conforming side setback and the person wants to do an addition, but they're not creating any new violation, like coming closer to a property line, then they can come to the Zoning Board for a review that is a determination or a finding that the change isn't substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood than the existing non-conforming aspects of the property. It takes a majority to approve such a finding, so that's in Northampton's case, that's 2 out of 3 members of the Zoning Board have to vote to approve. A second type of permit is a special permit. There are very few that the Zoning Board reviews. But there are, they review signs, any special permits that are above and beyond what the zoning allows, they grant special permits. It goes to the zoning board. They also review detached accessory apartments. Those trigger special permits. So the zoning board has jurisdiction over those. The board has to find that there's something unique about the property or that it meets certain goals of the city and planning objectives in order to grant that, and it takes a supermajority or unanimous vote to approve. So 3 of 3 members have to approve special permits. The third type of permit that the zoning board reviews is variance, which is also under Section 9, nonconformities. They're rarely requested and rarely granted because they really are situations in which the applicant is saying to the zoning board, there's nothing I can do with my property. I need some relief here. I need to have the rules waived for me because I have a unique circumstance. And the board really, under state statute, can only grant a variance if there's no other viable use of the property. It affects that lot differently from any other lot within the same zoning district. And it has something to do with the topography or somehow the geography of that parcel that makes it impossible to use for the under the rules that are set for that zone. So, and in a variance, you also need a unanimous vote to approve 3 of 3 members. So that's just sort of backdrop for this.
Can you give us an example of, go ahead.
Councilor Barch, go ahead.
Okay, looking at this language, I wish my husband was here. What I'm hearing is that this is addressing an old court ruling, correct?
Right. So I'll, not an old court ruling, a very recent court ruling.
Well, an odd.
Oh, an odd, I'm sorry.
There you go.
Yeah, yes.
Okay, so the court apparently had stated that if a property was pre-existing, right, non-conforming, in some cases property owners can do enormous expansions, right, that do not comply. Is
right.
that what happened?
That's what, right, and so now I'm gonna, I was gonna
well,
go in and explain that,
right,
about how that affects, how the court ruling has precipitated this proposed change that's on the floor.
Is this something similar to what occurred on North Street? Does this have anything to do with this?
No.
No?
No. I can't think of anything on North Street. If
I was just thinking about Doug Cole's property.
Oh, no. That was a special permit review by the planning board.
Oh, okay. Okay, I understand it.
So what's happened is that the Mass Appeals Court is driving this change just for single and two-family homes. That the court basically said a variance is no longer required if you're creating a new nonconformity. So if you were 10 feet from your property line and you're required to be 15 feet, under our current rules in Northampton, if you wanted to be 2 feet from your property line, that requires a variance. But now the court's saying that's not a variance. That's just a zoning board has to make a finding. So anybody could do that. So I just have a graphic up here to try to explain that the current zoning is sort of, we've always said this is a finding where you're just sort of extending along a non-conforming side setback. And always if you're creating a new violation going on the other side or even coming closer to a property line, that's been a variance. The court says just in the case of single and two family homes, it's not a variance. It doesn't trigger a variance. So basically what this means is if you have a vacant lot anywhere in the city, you have to build according to the zoning standard. If your structure conforms to zoning, you always have to conform no matter what additions you want to add on. Mm-hmm. If you have a non-conforming structure or a lot, then you're basically, it's wide open. You can ask for anything. Because you're non-conforming by 1 inch or 1 foot, then you can just sort of spread out all over your property, come closer to every property boundary, as long as the zoning board makes a finding that says it's not substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood than the existing non-conformity. So what's being proposed, so it's the board still has to make that determination, but what's in front of you is an ordinance that would say this should be a special permit. So this should require a unanimous vote of the zoning board, because it really is a substantial change in the way the city's been doing business, and it really says, you know, if you have this existing structure, it's no longer a variance. What we've been telling people in neighborhoods all along is that it's not a variance to try to get closer to your property line, and you can come to the board and get a finding, but call it a special permit and require that 3 out of 3 members to vote. So we feel like it's a significant change in the way the city's been doing business, but the special permit is at least a mechanism to have, you know, special attention paid to the permit request. And, you know, if we didn't have so many non-conforming structures in the city, it might not affect a city like Northampton as much. You know, if the zoning was matched more to what's on the ground, then people couldn't apply for these expansions that before, up to this point, had not been allowed. So that's basically, that's the ordinance.
Any questions? Yeah. So prior to this, our determination was whether or not what you were asking for was going to become more non-conforming than what was there.
Right.
And the state had thrown a wrench in the works that said, if you're non-conforming, you can be non-conforming anywhere you want on the lot. No.
The court, yeah.
The court, even if your building was set on an obscure and you started off at 8 feet and you were supposed to be 15 mm-hmm. feet, yeah. And you could build along that line and get within 2 or 3 feet.
Right, and any other line, and you can.
Or any line.
Right.
So they took out whether, it's just non-conforming. They
right.
got rid of whether you are more non-conforming or, okay.
Right.
Thank you.
Okay, you answered it.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Hi.
Councilor
Casey? Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Freeman Daniels?
Aye.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Passing first reading. This is to increase height limits in office industrial, general industrial, and central business district by 5 feet. I'll accept a motion. Actually, we never did get explanation for that. Positive recommendation, planning board. It was amended with PB language. So this is as amended. And it comes out with a positive recommendation. So.
I move approval and waive reading.
There's a motion.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion, any questions for Carolyn? Or Carolyn, do you want to give a brief overview?
Yeah, just quickly. I mean, it really adds 5 feet to some of our commercial districts, really to enable the possibility of potentially building one more floor on a building. In some cases, that 5 feet would make the difference. So, and then potentially minimize the footprint.
So, Carolyn, what it actually does is it adds an extra floor, correct, to the building?
Potentially that we understand that additional 5 feet in this range could allow for another floor that might not have otherwise been allowed under either a 65-foot height limit
so
or a 45.
So go from 65 to 70.
Right.
Right.
In central business.
Or either 40 to 45.
Right.
Right.
In the industrial districts.
Okay. So then by adding that whole extra floor, you're looking at more jobs and you're looking at more taxes.
If right, if it
hopefully.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Yeah, no, but I'd like to say we kicked this around quite a bit. The 5 or 10 feet, whether it be 5 feet or 10 feet, and 5 feet is perfect.
Just right. Most of those upper stories have taller ceilings anyway, so clearly no one's gonna build a floor that's just 5 feet high. You're next. If you
yeah, I'd like to separate my motion that I'd like us to waive the reading. That's a separate motion. I made it as one motion.
Moved
I just
and waived it.
Yeah,
trying to
I'd like to move it and then waive it.
All right, so the motion was, one, put it on the floor, which we're doing. And now there's a motion to waive reading, and it's been seconded. All those in favor of waiving the reading, which is not going to require a roll call.
Aye.
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 So now we're back to the motion.
I think we snuck in there.
Just cleaning up the rules.
Move to overrule.
Well, it is. Are you calling the question?
Yep.
Yes.
It's an order.
Yeah. I mean, this has been batted around a lot.
Well, yeah. Maybe it hasn't. Could I just ask her one more question, please?
Sure.
All right. So by doing what this is actually there for is not going to put a negative impact on others. Otherwise, if you didn't do this, it would.
We don't think it will have a negative impact on abutters. It's a small enough height increase, and in fact, when you're doing a brand new building, you need planning board review anyway. So anything over 5,000 square feet will get reviewed. But central business is our most intense district, so we want to create opportunities as much as possible for economic development and maximizing the lot. The build out of a lot. And in the industrial districts, they're for the most part separated from residential districts. They're not typically mixed use districts. I mean, there's some allowances for residential use, but we think that, again, it's an opportunity to better utilize space on the site.
Okay. Thank you, Carolyn.
Councilor Freeman Day.
I think that there is a possibility that some of these height changes could be slightly more detrimental to abutters, but I also think that 5 feet to allow for an extra floor is probably a wise economic decision, especially in the central business district.
Mm-hmm. And as Carolyn mentioned, it's subject to review and input from abutters, the process of that.
Okay.
Roll call, please.
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor
Yes.
Councilor
Carney? Yes.
Councilor
Yes.
Councilor
Yes.
Councilor
Yes.
And last, and actually not least, is general advertising signs may not be reconstructed to contain electronic technology. This comes with, this is also as amended. Is there a motion?
I'd like to move to split the question.
A motion to divide the question, to split the question.
Second it.
I'd like to split the question between the first paragraph and the second paragraph.
The councilor has made a motion, and it's been seconded by Councilor Barge to split. So the first paragraph, split the two paragraphs, first paragraph. All non-conforming non-accessory signs and lawfully erected before the adoption of this chapter may continue to be maintained, notwithstanding anything to the contrary. This existing sign structures may not be replaced. Once a sign falls into disrepair, no proposed new non-accessory signs shall be permitted in any district from and after the adoption of this chapter. That's the motion. That's one motion. And the other motion will be for, nor may existing non-accessory sign panels be reconstructed to add, modify, convert to LED or any other electronic sign technology. You've spoken the question. Do you want to make a motion on both? Or you want to motion one at a time?
Yeah, I'd like to motion the second one first. Move approval on the second paragraph.
So you want to move the second paragraph up to the first discussion?
Yes. Yep.
The second? Okay.
Second.
Would you like to talk with Carolyn about that first, or do you want to make
it? I think Carolyn will agree. I don't want to put words in her mouth, but I think most of our counselors will agree that we do want to limit or prohibit LED sign displays as being bright and loud, and something that we don't want to encourage in Northampton. Is that's and I think that's the primary motivation for this for this ordinance change. So I think that that should easily win the approval of the majority.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. I don't want a casino sign or that type flashing lights, and I think that's I just don't think this is the community for that. And I will support the second this paragraph.
Just like to hear from Carolyn maybe on how the separating of these two would impact.
Sure. Yeah. I think originally there had been some interest. We had gotten requests about adding or discussing the addition of a provision or a prohibition against the sign, electronic signs and LED signs. And so when we went in to look at the ordinance, we again took that opportunity to see if there was anything else that needed to be addressed in that particular paragraph. So the key issue here is the electronic signs. Again, we wanted to, I think the general standard of interpretation has been to, allow these billboards to be maintained, but not rebuilt. But there's been an instance where someone has interpreted the word maintained to be different. You know, it clearly that caused a concern by at least one property owner about what that means and what this ordinance change would mean. It's really not an issue for the planning office to, in terms of separating these two, and even just not moving forward the other clarification, because the language can stand as it stood since 1975, for all that's, or actually I should say 1979. So if you move just the one paragraph and leave the other one as unchanged, you know, that's fine. We would certainly support that. I think it makes sense based on the concerns.
I am highly against the electronic billboards, and I will support that part, and I'm glad that we are separating this ordinance, because it's just not one resident. There's two who have great concerns of the language in that ordinance about if you have it on your property and somebody is renting from the owner and so forth. It's maintaining it that's very critical here. Mm-hmm. Okay, and it really put a block on an owner once a sign needed to be repaired, or if they did not want to deal with the company again, they could not replace. Okay, so I'm so happy to hear about that.
Counselor.
Yeah. Not only it's a pre-existing, I don't find billboards offensive. I don't. And if Lamar decided that a property owner was asking too much for the lease payment, and they decided not to go forward with their lease any further, in their lease, written into their lease, is that they have to dismantle the sign. So if they did, if Dayton, another advertising agency, was a higher bidder for the property owner, they couldn't build the sign because Lamar would take theirs down, and then the next guy couldn't build one. So what you end up doing is you take this away from so you take a pre-existing non-conforming use, something that is, let's call it grandfathered, I don't really like the word too much, that you have taken this away from the property owner, something that they depend on this income on their property, and they've had it for all these years. I mean, it's like going into, I want to make something really off the wall, like Big Y, and tell them you can't sell milk anymore.
We're on the second paragraph.
This is and I'm allowing conversation on both, in that it's divided, kind of a holistic reference. But just for folks who are struggling to follow along at home, we're actually what you've just heard in the last two portions of debate and discussion, we're discussing the first section that's in controversy. Clearly, the second one doesn't seem to generate a lot of controversy here. Councilor Adams, do you want to speak to the second part?
Yeah, I think that it may require some redrafting. Well, we might not be there yet, so I'll withhold. But if the first paragraph, if it doesn't last, it may require some redrafting.
Redrafting so that the second paragraph
makes sense.
The proper ordinance and makes sense.
Right.
Yes, because right now it starts with a nor.
Exactly.
Which,
exactly.
And
right.
Nor would seems to indicate that something else exists in front of it.
Right.
But actually, something will exist. This is just amended language that's changing. The existing language that stands, established in 1979, so it'll be referring to that paragraph that's already existing.
Right.
Again, I'm speaking hypothetically. I don't know if it'll fail the vote, although. I'm reading tea leaves.
I'd like to move the question on the second paragraph.
Okay.
That
will be a roll call vote.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Freeman?
Aye.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor
yes.
Schwartz?
Yes.
Yes.
All right, now to the second part, which has already been moved, seconded.
Which is really the first part.
We are killing Councilor Murphy by degrees right now. Is there a discussion of that?
Yeah, thank you. I'm going to just basically echo what Councilor Tacey says, but in a different way, or I'm going to try to clarify it at least a little bit, because what happens a lot of the time is that the person who's a local person who owns, or maybe a local partnership or something that owns the rights to the billboard, they don't own the billboard itself. They usually lease it. And
the structure.
Yes, the structure. And it's a long-term lease, you know, 10, 15 years, whatever it happens to be. And when the lease is up, If the rights holder does not renew with the leasee takes down the structure. The previous interpretation was that when the rights holder signs a new lease, the leasee puts up a new structure, and as long as it's not any more nonconforming than it was before, that's acceptable. What I think this first paragraph does is it destroys the negotiating power of the local rights holder. The rights holder now cannot negotiate, because if the rights holder doesn't want to use that one provider, the provider they already have, and they sign with a different one, they are unable. That new one will be unable to put up a billboard, because one will have already been taken down. And by the way, this is written, they could not replace it. So what it effectively does is it creates a monopoly, or actually, I think, a monospony, where there's only one purchase, there's only one valid purchaser, one valid lessee, and whenever that happens, the economics of the situation will become just bad enough for the local rights holder, so that they will they'll sign a contract instead of getting a certain amount per month, they'll get far less, and that will actually hurt the city's tax revenue. But it's also not fair. So I'd like to offer an amendment based on the principle of fairness, and that would be to amend to delete that the first underlined sentence, existing sign structures may not be replaced, and to offer an amendment in its place, a sentence that says existing sign structures may be replaced as long as they are no more nonconforming than they were previously. Existing structures may be replaced as long as they are no more nonconforming than they were previously.
Yeah, I think the way, I just want to make sure that councilors understand that the current language without this new underlined sentence has been interpreted that the word, and it falls down to the word maintained, maintained has been interpreted on many occasions for many decades, I think, to be ordinary maintenance, not necessarily reconstruction or replacement. And so there are different places in the codes that talks about what does maintenance mean. But I think that there has been, at least certainly on one occasion and perhaps more, an interpretation of maintaining allows the reconstruction. So I would say, you know, if we didn't do anything with this paragraph, the fallback position is sort of the general understanding of what that word maintain means and the way it's interpreted, and ultimately it would be interpreted by the building commissioner if an applicant were to come forward. So I think the certainly staff's reason for coming forward with the clarification is because there has been other interpretations of what maintain means, and this was in order to clarify sort of what the general understanding of maintenance was in city department. So if you were to suggest adding language that clearly says reconstruct, I think that's a new ordinance and needs to be re-advertised and for a new public hearing, because I don't think it was the understanding that that billboards could be redeveloped forever and ever into time. And so I think it's a valid question to be had.
You're saying there's been significant, the language has changed significantly so that it is now qualifying as a new ordinance. The spirit of the original ordinance as interpreted by staff was that essentially the billboards were eventually just supposed to collapse under their own weight or something and never be rebuilt again.
Right.
No, that's not true.
Not true at all.
Oh, no.
Well, hang on a second. I was asking your opinion, and if other councilors want to speak their opinion, let's hear them. So, Councilor Freeman Daniels.
I'm sorry, I spoke out of turn.
Okay.
I apologize.
I'll just ask. It seems as though the intent of this was actually to limit the use of billboards rather than to liberalize, and actually the amendment would almost take this in 180 degrees. So in that sense, it does seem as though it would be really a new ordinance, and should, if we do choose to at least offer this, we should do it with public input and enough hearing, enough space so that people could address those issues, because the intent of this was really to limit then the practice of interpreting maintaining as reconstruction rather than liberalize that understanding. And that's what this amendment seems to do. So I would agree with Carolyn that maybe this, if we do go forward with this, it has to go out to a public hearing.
Yeah, everything in this paragraph says that we don't want any billboards. Even the last sentence, no proposed new non-accessory signs shall be permitted in any district from and after the adoption of this charter. Once the sign falls into disrepair, if I were to vote on it, I would just vote no and just eliminate this whole.
This is existing language, just so.
Yeah.
So we're actually voting on amended language. And so the existing language, without an amendment, doesn't require a vote unless we're going to redraft the ordinance. Councilor Freeman Daniels.
Two things. First thing is, I'm not sure if my amendment got a second.
It didn't.
Okay. All right. It did. Second thing is that when we're talking about maintain, the meaning of the word maintained, if the previous building commissioner interpreted maintained to be reconstruction, then that's what the previous building commissioner interpreted maintained to be. What this amendment is doing is clarifying, is actually just reinforcing what the building commissioner has already been doing. It's actually, what's going on is that the sentence existing sign structures may not be replaced is the opposite of what the building commissioner, what the practice has been. So it's clarifying in the sense that it's the planning board saying that we don't want what the building commissioner's been doing for the last few decades to continue.
And what that will do are all the economic ramifications of unfairness. It's creating a monopsony that is going to basically drive down the local revenue from these billboards. So, yeah, actually what we're doing, what my amendment does is clarify the current practice. And what the underlying sections do is destroys that practice.
So we're discussing the amendment. Councilor Murphy?
I wrote it down. Existing structures may be replaced as long as they are no more nonconforming than they were previously. I'll give it to you.
Councilor Murphy? Did you have something to say?
It's fine. But I just have a question, though.
Sure.
And I'll ask this to Carolyn. So if this were to pass tonight, do you think that we'd be in some violation of not having enough of a public hearing on this?
As the proposed language change, yes. And I guess if I could go back a little bit in history and just sort of with the zoning ordinance and sort of how cities have dealt with this since the 60s is that, you know, there's a way to amortize billboards, and many communities have done that, saying there's a date certain at which billboards must go away. And in fact, in 1975, the Northampton zoning ordinance said this, almost the precise language that's here, except not the underlying text, and then had a 5-year time frame. All billboards shall be taken down in 5 years. In 1979, the language is amended to be the language that we have now. So it was sort of a slower progression of the elimination of billboards. And over the decades, we've had, I think, two billboards that have gone away. One, I believe, on King Street, and one, I don't know, on entirely sure if it was on Route 10 to East Hampton, but it's my understanding that two have gone. And that there's one instance in which there was a reconstruction. Otherwise, they've stayed the same. So there's been one interpretation, but overall, I think the interpretation has been that, you know, you can continue to maintain them, but the goal eventually is that they would fade away.
So your understanding of the change that was made in 1979 was to allow billboards to attrit, or to just end by attrition as opposed to by date certain.
Right.
Which is what the previous language said. So it was amended to allow for attrition, not for just a continuum of rebuilding different billboards, putting in similar size billboards, but replacing the ones that were falling into disrepair.
Right.
Councilor LaBarge.
Of the maintaining part of it. I have to agree with Councilor Owen Freeman Daniels about people's property rights here. I'm having a problem with saying, you know, if you need to have it repaired or if it's taken down, another one cannot be placed up there again.
May I make a recommendation then that we postpone voting on this and that we are redrafting and presenting and discussing in public an ordinance that would reflect the community's will regarding billboards? And we're still on the amendment, I'm sorry. Is Councilman?
Well, at the
we're
very
still
least,
on the amendment.
Yeah.
Since we passed the second half of it,
right,
when that comes back for second reading, that's gonna have to be cleaned up a little bit so it stands on its own.
Oh, yeah.
Neatly.
Yeah, I think it would stand on its own because the existing paragraph is there. So if you decide to just scrap all the changes from paragraph one, the existing language would stay, and
just
then that second paragraph
would
be there.
So if tonight we vote against the first paragraph, then the second paragraph takes care of the electronic conversion part, and whatever has been happening continues to happen.
Until there's...
Whatever it is.
Right.
Right. And the concern is clearly there's a sentiment here, and maybe it's incumbent upon us to clarify the will of the community relative to billboards at some point. This is on the amendment.
Can I just to point out that if this amendment fails, that's okay. And if that's existing language just stayed in place. Billboards are rare in Northampton, and they're rare up and down the 91 corridor, and they're so rare that they're worth quite a bit of money. Mm-hmm. And so they're very few of them are ever going to go away. All that's going to happen is that the lessees will continue to offer less and less money to the rights holders. And the rights holders are generally local or local people or local partnerships or local companies. So I don't see any of this language in the first paragraph as really doing anything to sunset billboards. It's just going to sunset the flow of rent to our local landowners.
I don't disagree. I just think that there needs to be some time maybe to get better clarity about the implications of this.
I withdraw my amendment.
Amendment's withdrawn. So we're no longer debating that amendment.
That's fine.
So we'll vote the amended language that was presented. Does anyone want to discuss that on the first paragraph?
First paragraph.
And we're voting up or down whether we're voting on this amended language that's presented to us.
And will you read the amended language?
I can read that for you. It's all non-conforming, non-accessory signs in existence and lawfully erected before the adoption of this chapter may continue to be maintained, notwithstanding anything contrary in this 350, is that right? I can't make that out. 357. Existing sign structures may not be replaced. Once a sign falls into disrepair, no proposed new accessory sign.
It must be eliminated.
I'm sorry, it must be eliminated, thank you. Yeah, so once a sign falls into disrepair, it must be eliminated. No proposed new non-accessory signs shall be permitted in any district from and after the adoption of this chapter. That's the amended language. Mm-hmm. Councilor Tacey.
Yeah, I intend to not support this. Just on property rights and the wealth of the community. And that's all I got to say. I don't intend to support.
And this is zoning, so this needs a supermajority.
That's correct. It needs 6 votes to pass.
Six votes.
Any other discussion?
That's Tom Molitor.
Just could we have this?
Jesse. Tom Molitoris and Joe Molitoris on Park Hill Road, on the corner of Florence Road.
Is she a doctor?
He owns quite a bit of property.
It was a suggestion.
What are we doing?
We're waiting.
Sorry. Right, thank you.
All right, we're all set for the roll call?
Mm-hmm.
No.
No.
Councilor Murphy?
No.
Councilor Schwartz?
No.
Councilor Tacey?
No.
Councilor
No. Okay, so the existing language stands, and the second paragraph it has been passed. So the second paragraph now reinforces the existing language, and I do think at some point we should consider clarifying the intent. And also, at the same time, check the temperature of the community as to what their feelings are regarding.
Okay.
Carolyn, thank you so much.
Carolyn, John.
Really appreciate the time you put into this. And
no problem.
We are going to beat the deadline if we go by that clock, if we go by the real clock on the planet. Because, so.
Good.
next thing on the agenda is information request. For charter provisions. What is this? Okay. That's right. It's under the new rules, the information requests. That's right, under the new rules. Any other? No? Information requests?
Nope.
Okay. No new business? I'll accept a motion.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you all.
We got 200.